It's time for TWiT This Week in Tech. A great panel joining us from all over the world, Upper New York State, Nairobi, Kenya, and right next to me to talk about the Google Chromebook, Windows 8, a success or a flop, and is it time for a social network for dogs? We'll find out next on TWiT.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Audio bandwidth for This Week in Tech is provided by the new WinApp for Android, featuring wireless sync and one-click iTunes import. Now with free daily music downloads and full-length CD listening parties. Download it for free at winamp.com/android. Video bandwidth for TWiT is provided by CacheFly at cachefly.com. This is TWiT, This Week in Tech, episode 382, recorded December 2nd, 2012, The Pump and Dump. This Week in Tech is brought to you by Stamps.com. Start using your time more effectively with Stamps.com. Buy and print real U.S. postage the instant you need it, right from your desk. For our special offer, go to Stamps.com now, click on the microphone, and enter TWiT. And by GoToAssist from Citrix. Take control of your IT world from one simple cloud-based platform. Provide live or unattended support for all your users anywhere. Sign up for your 30-day free trial today. Go to assist.com. Use the promo code TWIT. And by ice.com. Give your special lady a beautiful piece of jewelry for Christmas this year with a TWIT exclusive offer from ice.com. 25% off most items, plus free guaranteed delivery by Christmas. Get your big discount on fine jewelry now through December 19th at ice.com/TWIT. And by Gazelle, the fast and simple way to sell your iPhone, iPad, MacBook, or other smartphones. Find out what your gadget's worth right now at gazelle.com. It's time for TWiT This Week in Tech, the show that covers the week's tech news. This is the analysis show. You know, you want the daily news, the day-to-day news information. Of course, we've got Tech News Today with Tom Merritt. But every week, every Sunday, we get down, we sit down, we talk. I always thought of it as kind of a hot stove kind of a conversation where you kind of say, well, what about and how about them and that kind of thing. And, of course, that's why we bring in this guy, John C. Dvorak, dvorak.org/blog. He is the king of the hot stove tech commentary.
Yeah, I got nothing else to do.
No, but it's good. It's fun. It's and flannel is suits you.
Flannel is my new, is the new silk.
Well, I think in the summer you should wear those Beach Boys shirts you were wearing, and in the winter you could wear a plaid flannel.
It's cold out.
It is cold,
and it's raining,
and it's very rainy.
Yeah,
and that's what made me think of the hot stove thing. Just if
the Cracker Barrel.
Crackle Barrel.
The pickle barrel, sitting around.
Play a little checkers.
Eating pickles.
Eating pickles. That kind of thing.
That kind of thing, yeah.
Tim Stevens is here. He's the urbanite here from Engadget.com, editor-in-chief there. Do you live in New York City, Tim?
Actually, I don't. I'm way up in the country out around Albany, New York, so I'm actually out in the middle of nowhere myself.
Oh, well, never mind. You understand Cracker Barrel better than anybody.
I do. There are many Cracker Barrels around here. Many to choose
There's
from.
There's actual restaurant.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, called the Cracker Barrel. And they have, like, all sorts of memorabilia on the walls. Where does, you know, all of those restaurants that do that, you know, TGI Fridays and all the ones with the flair.
Flair.
Is there a company that, like, churns duck decoys and old advertising signs out for these? There can't possibly be
eBay
that much stuff that they could
There actually is a factory for Cracker Barrel to make that stuff. And you can buy anything off the wall. If you see something that you like, you can just point at it, and the waitress will pull it off for you and sell it to you if you want it.
And then they have more in the back room.
Absolutely.
Okay. I thought these can't be real antiques because there can't be that much. Now I understand. It's Cracker Barrel / Pick and Pay.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. Now we're appealing to the rural folks. And now, believe it or not, Mike Elgan is back with us. Last time we spoke to Mike Elgan, he was in the Peloponnese in Greece studying up the Spartan diet. And he's moved on to Nairobi, Kenya. Hello, Mike Elgan.
Hello. Thank you for having me on.
What a great connection. So you've got good internet there.
Yeah, it's fantastic. And I have, I'm staying with my cousin here, and it's a beautiful house in a lovely area. And it's fantastic. We've been here 2 weeks.
Are you going to stay there for a while? Because we should explain that for those who don't know, Mike has kind of done this cord cutting thing, but instead of cutting off the cable company, he's cutting off the entire United States of America.
Yeah, no offense, fellow Yankees. Nothing wrong with America. It's no, I'm a digital nomad or a Bedouin or whatever you call it. But basically, because I write for a living and my work is literally location independent, doesn't matter where I am. I live in different countries for a few months and then move to another country just for the hell of it. As John was saying before we started rolling the show, just to prove a point. And also to have a lot of fun. So yeah, I'm in Kenya now for probably another couple, 3 months, and maybe more. It's actually really awesome here. I really like Kenya.
You don't have an itinerary then. You don't say like, oh well, by January we've got to be somewhere. You can be anywhere you want, anytime you want.
It's pretty vague. I hope to go to mobile and wireless in Barcelona early next
year.
That's
a great event.
So we'll probably go to Spain next just to do that. And I may try to hit certain shows if it kind of works out. But no, we don't have an agenda at all other than the fact that we want to live in France, we want to live in Spain, we want to live in India. There's a bunch of places where we'd really like to live, and we intend to do that. So it's really working out great. And, you know, it's funny because I kind of did this for about 4 months back in 2008. And now it's a whole new world with Skype working as well as it does, with Google Plus Hangouts, with social media. There's just no reason to be stuck in a house if you don't have to be.
I've noticed that travel has really changed. Well, the first time I went to Europe as a kid in 1967, you couldn't get baseball scores. You had to wait till the Herald Tribune came out the next day and you'd get the baseball score. Even the beverages were a little weird. They didn't have Coke.
And they had this funny sized cans.
Yeah, they had Afri-Cola. They didn't. I mean, it was foreign.
Now they got Coke.
Now it just really feels like it's all the same. We've a little bit homogenized now.
Yeah. You'd see a lot of people with cell phones, and this is a country where you have the whole range of people from destitute poverty all the way up to pretty wealthy, and the first, you know, if they get anything before they get a computer, before they get a calculator, before they get a digital watch, they'll get a cell phone.
Yeah.
Because that's the and in Kenya is actually pretty advanced. They have mobile payments. Almost everybody pays for stuff with cell phones around here.
That's actually an interesting story, because there is a company that people don't in the U.S. have never heard of that is huge in this space, much bigger than PayPal. What is the name of it? They do global payments. I'm sure they're big in Kenya.
Yeah, I don't know the name. I haven't gotten a local phone yet, but it's I've just been observing that everybody is using this thing to pay, and it's as far as I can tell in most, you know, reasonable stores. I mean, not talking about the roadside stands and stuff like that, but the stores all, you know, it's more common than cash.
Yeah, and in fact, so much so that there are even people who have. I know this is the case in Africa and some other areas in India probably too, who have cell phones who don't have regular power. So they will go to a vendor to plug in their phone, street vendor, plug in their phone to power it up.
Yeah.
Is it M-Pesa? Is that the one? I think that's it. M-P-E-S-A.
That's what somebody says.
Thank you in the chat room. This company is massive. I think
this thing's dead in the water, my machine.
And we'll get your machine online. Sorry about that, John. Tim, do you go to Mobile World Congress in Barcelona every year? I bet you do.
I don't personally, but we do send a big team there for sure. It's getting bigger every year, and this year should be really big. They're moving to a new venue, and it sounds like it's going to be a major event. So we'll be covering it, but I don't think I'll personally be getting.
Yeah, it struck me last year that we should have been there. That's where Windows Phone 8 was announced.
Yeah,
with great fanfare, a bunch of new Android phones. It seems to be that is the most, right now, vital conference, even maybe more so than CES.
You should cover it.
I think
it's definitely growing very quickly, for sure.
Yeah, and Barcelona is a great. That's why you want to go there, because you want.
I didn't say I wanted to go, but I would. Yeah. You're inviting me? Is that what the deal is?
Sure, you could be our Barcelona. We sent you to Spain last year, didn't we?
That was Madrid.
Madrid.
Yeah.
Yeah, wasn't that fun?
Yeah.
Barcelona. Now, isn't Barcelona...
have Ford loan us one of those little cars.
We could do it. M-Pesa comes from M for mobile. Pesa is Swahili for money. It's a microfinancing service for Vodacom and Safaricom, the largest mobile network operator in Kenya and Tanzania. It is the most developed mobile payment system in the developing world. It's huge. It's actually taken over banking for lots of the undeveloped world. Mm. M-P-E-S-A. It's 9 million customers as of late 2009. 40% of Kenya's adult population. That must be the one you're seeing, Mike.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it is, and I'm almost sure certain that it is. Somebody in the chat room asked what the OS is that people are using on their phones, and that's the interesting thing about that. It's almost all feature phones
right
here,
right?
And also Turkey and also Greece. I've been kind of shocked in this whole thing to see the number of people who have feature phones that don't have smartphones yet.
Yeah, well, their days are numbered.
Well, and exactly why. Companies like Google and Apple are looking with great interest to the rest of the world. It's a huge opportunity for them. And I think actually Android probably has an advantage there. What is, maybe Tim, you understand this. Why did RIM just gain a huge amount in the stock market? Is there suddenly a bullishness over BlackBerry 10?
I haven't heard anything particularly, recent. I know that they are definitely talking to a lot of international carriers to do a big worldwide launch. And I know that in developing nations like Kenya, this, a big part of where they want to be a player over the next year. But no, there hasn't really been any recent revelations. And I don't think we're going to be hearing much of anything until, their big January 30th announcement, when we finally see the full retail hardware devices and get the full details on when they're going to ship the things.
I think an analyst boosted his recommendation. The stock market listens to these guys. And apparently there is a contrarian theory that if RIM can just convince its existing customers to stick around for a little while, that when BlackBerry 10 comes out, they might actually not only keep their existing customer base, which is still pretty decent, but also start to win over iPhone and Android users.
Yeah, they're crazy.
Have you seen BlackBerry 10? It does sound nuts.
No, it is nuts.
Have you seen BlackBerry 10?
I spent quite a bit of time with it. It's a great operating system. It looks really nice. I'd say it's right up there with the best of them as far as usability goes and intuitiveness. It's got amazing gesture control. You can really quickly jump from a meeting appointment to a conference bridge to directions to, your next meeting. It's all really intuitive and nice, but I don't know that it's quite enough to pull people in. But like you said, RIM's still got a very strong base. And interestingly, that base hasn't really shrunken. It's just that the market has grown so much. RIM hasn't been growing, or RIM's user base hasn't been growing enough to keep up with it. So it looks like they're shrinking, but really it's more or less flat for them. So next year is going to be very interesting for them for sure. It looks fantastic though, the US for sure. I just don't know that it's enough to topple iOS and Android.
Right. On Thursday, they jumped to over $12. From $11, a huge, increase.
Yeah, one of those things.
You see the stock price, the boom, like that. But and all because of this analyst. They were as low as $6.
Which analyst was it? It's a quick doubler. Get out, sell now. Double your money.
Has he posted anything to PRWeb this week, perchance?
That's quite a story too. We're going to get to that in a little bit. Boy, I'm not following PRWeb anymore.
I didn't know this story.
Oh, you haven't seen this one?
No.
Well, maybe we should. I'll tell you what. Let's take a break and we'll get to it. It was a rumor that was that Google was buying a company called Eikoa for $400 million.
Well, I did hear this.
You heard that rumor?
Yeah.
Well, it turns out that came from a PRWeb press release that was purchased by speculators in this Eikoa stock. And the whole point was to run up the stock price.
Ah, pump and dump.
Yeah, we'll talk about it. The problem poised by PRWeb. Do you want some jewelry?
What do you got there, Leo?
I got some jewelry.
Oh, so, this is for the new advertiser?
It's not new. We do this every holiday season because we know that our geeks do not know what to do for the ladies in their lives.
I think
right?
they know exactly what to do.
I got you a surge suppressor. I hope you like it.
Exactly. What's wrong with that?
You know, you really ought to have a surge suppressor
you
for your home theater, and I got you one. So I'm going to tell you something. Ladies don't want surge suppressors.
Is that right?
They want to be dripping in jewels. How would you like that? And I'll tell you where we sell. Oh, this is a nice piece.
Let's see.
Look at that. Those are real pearls, by the way.
USB port in it?
No.
So what's it for?
So ICE, I want to send you to ice.com/twit. ICE is a great place to buy jewelry, and I can vouch for that. Really gorgeous stuff at a very affordable price. And we have a special 25% offer. Actually, why don't you show the video? Because we shot some nice video of this jewelry. I just wanted to show John. These are beautiful rings. I'll give you some examples. 25% off. That is a black diamond rose gold over sterling silver. Actually, that one.
There's no black diamond there.
No, what is that? I don't know what the earrings. And this is none of the stuff I know anything about.
It's horrible.
We just have pictures of earrings.
Watch out, QVC.
Guaranteed delivery by Christmas for any order placed by December 19th. 25% off most items. Some restrictions do apply. If you go to ice. There it is. That's the one I was talking about. Get it in focus, Tony.
Are you going to start taking calls from customers?
No. That is a black diamond rose gold over sterling silver heart pendant with chain. How much would you pay for that? It's $95 normally, $71 with a TWiT discount. How about that? Look at those. Mm. The hoop earrings, quarter carat diamond, 14K pink gold. I love that. Normally $475. Our TWiT holiday price, $356. This is all at ice.com. We also have pearls. These are cultured freshwater pearl and diamond.
So this is not junk jewelry.
White gold ring. No, it's nice. But it's very affordable. $195 normally, $146 for our TWiT audience. Again, free
stuck on my finger.
Yeah.
I have to take it home.
Go ahead. You can. No, actually, I think we have to send this back.
Yeah, never mind.
There's a lot of jewelry in here, though. Look at these hoops.
I think my wife would go for this. This is her color.
No, these are this is saved beautiful. Me a huge... So here's the point, is that there's a big range of prices on here. So you can get something you can afford. What?
My wife's color.
That's big. Is that her color?
Yeah, exactly.
It's amethyst, right?
I don't know.
It's beautiful. Look at this.
So should Mike and I just pick our favorite and you'll ship it to us?
I'll ship it all right out to you.
That'd be great. I'm still Christmas shopping, so any help you can provide would be very appreciated.
We do this every year, and it's kind of, you know what I think we're going to do next year is like a whole, shopping segment. No. We're going to sell anything. We're not going to sell anything on the, actually, we are going to sell something. I got to show you something else we're selling. Anyway, that's ice.com/twit. Free guaranteed delivery in time for Christmas if you order for now through December 19th. And 25% off most items. It's very easy. If she doesn't like it, it's very easy to return it. She can pick something else. Very simple to do. I am a big fan. ice.com/twit. Let me show you what we are selling, though, in our store. I haven't showed you this yet. How do you like these, John? TWiT mugs. This is a...
You've always had TWiT mugs.
We've always had them, but this is the first time we've had these with the colored gear logo.
No, these are nice, yeah.
Aren't they pretty? Yeah. And the insides match the orange.
Yeah.
And now there's two
Where are
kinds.
They? I don't see any on the set.
But you don't have any. They haven't made them yet.
Oh, you're doing this on spec.
Well, it did. Believe it or not, we've already sold 173, and all we had to do was sell 100. But they're printing them now. Every batch of 100, another set will go out. So if you order now, you'll get into the second set. $20 for two mugs. You have the 16-ounce or the 9-ounce. But
now that.
Do you see the spoon mug? What do you? Is that a good idea?
The spoon mug?
The spoon goes in the handle.
That's lame.
That's what I thought.
Yeah.
The girls love it. Everybody here.
Why?
I don't know why. All the guys said no.
Maybe it's the sexual innuendo.
No, it's not that. It's the cup is a perfect spoon holder. It's already built in. It's called a cup. Yeah. But and then that gets in the handle. But apparently the ladies
don't you poke yourself in the eye when you drink from it?
Yeah, I was going to say, I think that's what they were talking about when they say gouge your eye out with a spoon. I think they're referring to this. It looks very practical other than that if you drink very carefully. But wear eye protection, of course.
Anyway, two mugs for $20, very affordable. I don't know what this is. We're trying to raise money for something, but Lisa hasn't told me what yet.
Another trip to Australia is my guess.
Could be payroll. I don't know.
Payroll.
Go to the address for this is TWeSpring, TESpring.com/twitmugs. And this is a 7-day offer, so that's why I'm mentioning it now. It runs out in 1 week. So do not waste any time ordering. John, close your ears. These are the gifts we were going to give the TWiT hosts. And so we thought, oh, we should offer. We were getting these made for the TWiT hosts. And we thought, oh, we should offer these for sale as well on the TeeSpring site. So these are the TWiT gift hosts' Christmas presents.
That's it?
Huh? Now you can listen. Is the Apple working? The Mac?
Yes, it seems to be working now.
That looks good on you. He's got two rings in the pink gold. You look like Jack Benny when you do that. Oh, man.
Yep. I've come to save the show.
All right. So PR Web, which is, everybody knows PR Web and PR Newswire, right? These are two different companies that you can take if you have a press release.
Among others, Business Wire.
Business Wire is another one.
Another one, yeah.
If you have a press release, you give them the press release and you pay them, right?
Let me describe it a little more accurately. If you can't get any, you could write a press release, you can't get anybody in the world to pick it up because you got no mailing list and you're an incompetent bonehead, you give it to these people, give them money, and then they put it on their wire service, and then nobody picks it up anyway.
Well, that was what I thought.
Yeah.
Well. But it turns out that many news outlets use press releases from PR web, including Google News. Yep. And so, in fact, that's what's happening is that these are getting picked up, and you could put, it turns out, a spurious news release on PR web. Tim, is that what happened with ICOA?
Yeah, absolutely. The
love it.
Press release went out on PR web, and we saw it, and we were looking into it, and then we saw that the next web threw it up, so we went ahead and did the same. And
you put it on Engadget?
We did so.
Oh, no, they're not alone. They're not alone. Everybody did.
I didn't.
Lots of people did as well.
You're not a news outlet.
I am, too.
I'm very ashamed of myself.
The funny thing is that if you have the bottom of the barrel package with PR web, it doesn't go on Google News unless you upgrade to the $199 package.
Right.
And then it just automatically goes on Google News. But the thing is with these, their PR web is one of them, the other one you mentioned. There's like half a dozen of these things. And if you just scan through their daily press releases, each of these companies sends out somewhere between 10 and 150 press releases a day. And, you know, half of them are just garbage. Like somebody will, you know, do a vanity book or something like that and just write their own press release, put it on there, pay $149, and out it goes. And it's just the fact that it's showing up anywhere other than on these sites is just an example of the shoddiness of journalism and the sort of abandonment of any sort of editorial filter on anything.
Well, but it's a problem because I get a lot of email from publicists. I don't know if I get anything from these guys, but I get a lot of email from publicists because, you know, I'm mostly because of the radio show, so we're on every list in the world. It's so funny because they often offer me tech experts.
Oh, yeah. It's always hilarious.
Would you like somebody to come on your show and comment about how viruses are ruining everything? And they obviously are paying no attention to who they're sending this out to, right?
No, they don't pay any attention. What's the point?
But I get them all. And obviously, Tim Engadget, is Engadget subscribed to PR Web or does it just show up in the inbox?
We have a variety of tools for tracking different outlets and PR Web. We follow, I believe it's through RSS, actually. So we were seeing the PR through that. We were doing the investigation. We saw it pop up on a few other sites, and we made the erroneous assumption that those other sites had done the verification. We all know what happens when one makes an assumption, and of course, we will never make such an assumption again. In fact, there was another acquisition that came out on PR Web later that week that we, of course, ignored until we were able to verify it ourselves this time. But yeah, that's exactly what happened. Went out on PR Web. A few people went ahead and pulled the trigger without making the right phone calls, and then that ultimately led to the steamroll of everybody else doing the same thing, sadly, ourselves included.
Yeah, and
lot. Did you change your policy on that as a result?
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
You should issue a press release and announce that.
Yes, if only I knew where to go ahead and push that press release.
It's $199, that's all.
Okay. So for $199,
but that's cheap if you hired a publicist.
Oh, yeah, no.
How much is a publicist a month? Must have had that. I had a publicist from time to time. I've never had a publicist.
You don't need a publicist. You're a self-promoting maniac. A lot of companies will pay between...
I think it's like $1,500 a month, something like that. Yeah.
No, it's a lot more than that.
More than that?
Yeah, you generally about $5,000 a month is for starters.
And do they make any guarantees? They say, we're going to get you on Regis.
Well,
we're
if they get start you... doing that, then you got a phony, usually.
Right. They can't promise anything.
No. There's one guy in Marin County, I still think he's up there, who used to do it on a fee base. So you'd hire him, and then he had his little fee list. So if he got you in the Wall Street Journal, then you owed him $10,000.
That's worth it. Yeah, if you get on live with Kelly, that's 4 million people will see your product. That's huge.
Yeah, and what product were you selling there?
I never sell products.
See, that's a mistake. You should have had the mugs for sale.
You know, they told me when I started doing that in 2001. Tech TV set that up, right? And I've been doing it since then. I would go on and show gadgets. And I was going to wear, Tech TV actually had made for me a bunch of sleeveless sweater vests with the Tech TV logo on it. Like, I would wear that crap. But I did. I brought it out there, and I asked, and Gelman said, you can't wear that. What do you mean I can't? I'm the Tech TV. No, sorry.
No, they're really freaky
about
that.
They won't let you do that.
I was almost on one of the Bravo shows, I wasn't on it, but I was, you know, one of the guys in the on the set doing stuff that they were filming, and I had I knew they were going to do this, so I wore a No Agenda T-shirt, and they just were not putting up with that.
Yeah, they don't want you to do that.
No.
Anyway, so this PR web thing. Now, PR web, in theory, vets these, right? I mean, because otherwise this really would
be a
cesspool, because anybody who wants to pump and dump a stock just put out a press release.
I think this is a new idea for pump and dump.
Ah.
It is a cesspool.
And it is already, he's right, it's already a cesspool. And this was some clever guy, new idea for pump and dump, and it was genius.
And it worked. Won't work again, probably, but it worked once.
No, it won't work again.
PR web issued a press release. In which they said, we have since learned that that was a fraudulent press release from ICOA. The release was not issued or authorized by ICOA. Vocus, which is the parent company, PRWeb, reviews all press releases and follows an internal process designed to maintain the integrity of the releases we send out each day. Apparently, internal process that doesn't, in fact, involve calling the company issuing the press release. Even with reasonable safeguards, identity theft occurs. Oh, maybe, okay, so maybe it came from an address, at ICOA.com or something like that. Maybe that was what
they... Probably some phishing address.
That's easy to do. You can do that. Yeah. I can do that. I can send out an address from any email from any address I want.
Yeah.
We have removed the fraudulent release, turned the matter over to the proper authorities.
The police.
For further investigation. Danny Sullivan has a great analysis on search engine land. And in which he effectively implies that PR Web not only, you know, doesn't have a check, but in fact does this all the time. For instance, he points out a press release that comes out monthly from yourbestpillsonline.com. It's a press release titled "How to Buy Drugs: Lowest Price Viagra by Levitra Viagra Online Pill Store," and it has a completely bogus text. And the reason they do this is because... And this is the PR web. Oh, the places you'll go. Want to see where your news is going? Look no further. Major search engines, Associated Press. And what happens is, if you now do a Google search on this particular press release, you'll see, for instance, the Houston Chronicle is republishing press releases. Now, they have a special page. It's the Houston Chronicle PR web page. But this now gets published.
Yeah, this is ridiculous. This is going on
a newspaper website. It also shows up in Google News.
Just to create advertising inventory.
Right. Yeah. And
of
course,
the problem is that quite a few legitimate companies use PR Web as well. NBD, right, for example, sends out their releases through PR Web. And of course, you know, that's a well known company and those are legitimate. So, you know, that just means the onus is, of course, on us now, as it should be, to be verifying these things to make sure that they're correct. But hopefully, you know, we'll be seeing some companies maybe shifting away from PR Web, and maybe we'll see the other options that we mentioned before being a little bit more stringent in PR Web as well.
And it also led me to do a little digging. And, in fact, you can turn off press releases in Google News, which you might want to do.
Nice.
If you're in news.google.com, which I use. I like Google News.
Yeah, I use it.
There's a settings button by the sources. And look at this. There's apparently a setting. Personalized Google News, reflect your taste in publishers. Do you want press releases? And it's normally normal. You could turn that off. You can also, and that's
too
bad.
More.
You can put more.
Can I get only press releases?
Yes.
Yeah, you could.
You could turn off blogs and turn on press releases, and that's going to be a great feed for you. You're going to find lots of stocks you might want to invest in. What's sad is that they include blogs as well as press releases in that setting. You can add sources, but you cannot. I don't think you can remove sources, so you couldn't manually say no more PR Web. But at least you could say no more press releases, and I immediately did that. To my Google News feed. I didn't want to get any more of those.
There's a virtue in there somewhere with Google. They're trying not to be to exert editorial control over what's legitimate, right, and what isn't, and they're giving you the tools, if you're savvy enough, to go in there and make
that
decision.
That's the way to do it. Yeah.
Yourself. But it's really, there's no good answer to this kind of thing. When you talk about blogs, like I actually wanted to get my blog to post on Google News years ago, and their criteria for what's news and what's not a newsworthy blog is how many people are involved. So apparently, if you have one person doing
that's
the
interesting.
Blog, it's not legit. If you have two, then they'll post it on Google News. At least that was the case a few years ago. I don't know what it is now, but and I thought that's kind of a weird criteria. what else are you going to use if you're Google and you want to sort of have a hands-off approach on what's news and what isn't?
Well, while we're on the topic, I usually don't talk about no agenda stuff on this show, but I did discuss this because it was a news item that I thought was interesting. If you go to Google and type in "give frozen peas, P-E-A-S, a chance," you get two articles. One was because my wife called me and she's moaning about this. Dr. Oz wrote an op-ed for Time.com, and the op-ed is word for word the same as this as the top hit, which is this "give frozen peas a chance" and "carrots too," with the same art from this Dr. Nagel.
Oh yeah, you can see who's stealing from whom.
I don't think they were stealing. I think these were both planted articles from some PR company that were given exclusives. And one guy said, "I thought I had the exclusive."
Right.
You know about this, Mike? Whereas these companies will say, "Yeah, I got it. We wrote a piece for you. You can run it. You can use your own byline if you want to," and they don't even change a word of it, and you just run it under your own byline, and it goes out there, and everybody thinks that you wrote this thing. But in this case, two guys did it at the same time.
That's bizarre. And you have to think it's the Frozen Pea Council of America.
I think it's frozen foods. Because this is about frozen foods. I think it's about the frozen fruit food, and they make it sound like some article that, you know, sounds like somebody did write it, but... Both of these doctors live in a vegetarian household with da-da-da. Right. I mean, it's unbelievable that the Time magazine talking about
it
you guys...
It is possible that the other article stole Dr. Oz's
They
article.
Both came on almost simultaneously, and I don't think so.
That's interesting.
Because I've seen this sort of thing happen. It's always by accident, but it's because of the exclusive thing. So I got this... When I was editor at InfoWorld, we always solicit stuff. I used to have... A bunch of PR people say, "What can we do?" And I said, "Well, you can write an article." I never put anybody else's name on it.
You know what's changed everything is demand media.
Oh, yeah. Demand media is the big ones. In fact, yeah.
That's fascinating because basically somebody said, "Hey, you know, instead of us writing like as we do on TWiT, we say editorially, oh, these are the stories, let's talk about them. What if we just looked at what the search terms were and wrote stories that matched the most popular search terms?"
Right.
And then... we'll get high search rankings, and we can put an ad on there, and it's going to be a valuable product. So if it turns out people are searching for Harley-Davidson belt buckles, which apparently they are, they're going to find a demand media article about Harley-Davidson belt buckles. It'll have some nice ads on it.
They pay writers next to nothing.
And they pay the writer $5 because the writer didn't have to put much work into it.
Yeah. No, there's a...
I think that's changed this a lot.
The entire media is just... rank with corruption is terrible.
But, Tim, I know, I mean, look, Engadget is a serious journalistic enterprise.
I like Engadget.
I love Engadget, and there's no question about that. That's got to be a constant challenge.
Yeah, it absolutely is, especially with properties like, you know, everybody's basically trying to be first, and you're trying to basically get the recognition and get ahead of that wave on Twitter, and there's such a huge amount of traffic to be gained by being first. So, you know, and especially when these stories break early, this one broke, I think, before 8 a.m., and of course, Google PR wasn't even awake at that time. So, you know.
So you don't have time. You cannot wait and say, let's sit on this. Let's call ICOA. Let's call Google. There's a real urgency to getting this out, but there's the
risk. A lot of it's automated nowadays.
There's the risk. Yeah, that's tough. I think especially in your field, in the gadget field, it really is cutthroat.
It is definitely very cutthroat. And, you know, these things happen very quickly. But ultimately, you know, there were a few warning signs, which All Things Digital did a very good job of pointing out. Within this press release, there were no quotes from Google, for example, talking about the acquisition. There was, I think, a spelling mistake in there as well. So there were a few little things were red flags. So ultimately, you know, even without the confirmation, there were a few things that might have jumped out to us if we hadn't been in such a rush show. But again, there were a few other instances later that week of other press releases from Pierre Webb, and we made sure to verify those, and we will continue to do so going forward.
Well, I think this is, as with all pump and dump scams, it only works really the first time.
It works well. Yeah, well, there's, you know, they still do a lot of email pump and dumps, and those
forums
work.
The forums used to be a good source. Yeah. Pump and dump is what?
Pump and dump is where you take a position in some worthless stock, and then you dream up a bunch of bull crap, and you pump it into the market to get the stock pumped up. So you drop all this phony information in as fast as you can on blogs and all these things. Oh, it's a rumor that they're going to do this, they're going to do that. And to get – usually it's a penny stock. That way you can get the thing to skyrocket to go to a few bucks, and you slowly unload it in the price. You can't unload it all at once. You slowly unload it as it goes up. And then you pump, and then you dump, and then you're out, and then everybody else finds out the stock goes back down to one penny, and you made a bunch of money. You can make 10x in one of these schemes.
It's kind of amazing. And it still happens all the time.
Much of it is done by the mob.
What?
Well, you know, actually...
They do it with phone solicitations. Wow. They'll pump and dump on that with the call.
But this whole PR web thing is the latest in a series of ways by which kind of the media and the blogosphere has been duped by one group or another. This one happens to be with a press release. But remember that, I think it's the Day 4 blog, they came out with a hoax about Apple invented a proprietary screw, and everybody fell for it. Because, you know, you that's the kind of thing you want to happen, you expect to happen, and so you believe it when it happens. The India's $35 tablet, remember that?
Yeah.
Everybody was talking about, okay, it never happened, and everybody believes it happened because in this case, it was actually the a government minister in India who is propagating this hoax because he's trying to, you know, it's all politics. He's trying to get everybody to think that India's on the forefront. Turns out they ended up coming out with a device. It wasn't made in India. It didn't cost $35. It was a piece of junk. Nobody could use it. They didn't distribute to millions of students like they said they were going to. But they're still, even today, this has been going on for a year and a half, they're still trying to get credit for it, and the media is still lapping it up. You can still find all these $35 tablet stories in pretty legit things. And so this is, you know, there's just one organization and one individual after another duping the media and the blogosphere. Everybody's too busy to really track things down. And by the time somebody does track it down, it's out there.
And unless you think this is just blogs, it's just new media, Conan O'Brien had a little something that he did a few months ago. And I think this is a good example of lazy journalism.
Now, a lot of people, they look at the news these days and they think the big news stories today are, well, the new Al-Qaeda underwear bomb threat or where President Obama stands on gay marriage. People think those are the big stories. Well, judging by local news, there's an even bigger story that is sweeping the nation right now. Here's a look at today's real top story.
Thank you, Don. Well, we watch them on YouTube and post their pictures on Facebook, but is it time for dogs to have a social network of their own?
Is it time for dogs to have a social network of their own?
Is it time for dogs to have a social network of their own?
Is it time for dogs to have their own social network of their own?
Is it time for dogs to have a social network of their own?
Or is it time for dogs to have a social network of their own?
Wow. Is it time for dogs to have a social network of their own?
These are all local news anchors. And in some case, national news anchors.
Is it time for dogs to have a special social networking site?
Reading a press release.
Is it time for dogs to have a social network
common.
Of their own?
Is it time for dogs to have a social network of their own?
Is it time for dogs to have a social network?
Apparently, it's time for dogs to have a social network of their own.
This goes on and on.
I'm not convinced yet, Leo.
Is it time for dogs?
My dogs are not very social, actually, so I don't think.
Just keep watching because your local anchor will appear in this supercut at some point. It's hard to believe.
Yeah, they did this they do this a lot on
I love the supercuts. I don't know how they do it. They must have, and same thing with the Daily Show. Jon Stewart does this a lot.
There's some research, there's some databases now where you can.
But they must have text transcriptions.
You find one example of something. It's like I found the peas thing, because I wanted to read the article,
and
then I read it.
There must be a way to do that.
You can do it, and you
through the closed captioning systems, they can basically do a search based on that and get a time index in any news program to find
out. So an intern basically could do this.
Well, it's first you got to come up with the meme.
By the way, we still don't know if it's time for dogs to have a social network
I think
of their
it
own.
Is. I think it's time for dogs to have a social network of their own.
Is it time for dogs to have a social network of their own?
I think so,
I just do that to point out that no matter how many ways, you know, you complain about blogs and all of this, it's always been far worse than local news. It has always been far worse. They don't care. They don't have. And it's not even they don't have time. They don't. They have time. They only do two shows.
They have time and money.
At 5:30 and 11. That's it. They have plenty of time. And they still don't bother. I said, you got a press release I can read? Thank you. We're going to take a break. When we come back, I want to talk about a little more about Google, the Chrome OS notebook. Maybe Tim has an inside knowledge of this. Google reportedly going to do its own Chrome OS notebook. They've sold out of the one that Samsung made.
I was just going to mention, if people want to look into this, they can look at snapstream.com, which is a clipping service, and that's where
they do it.
I think so.
Snapstream. That sounds familiar. I think for a while we were using them for transcriptions on the podcasts. DVR and search engine technology. Wow. Monitor everything said on TV and then just search for it. That's incredible. It's only $1,000 a month, $15,000 a year.
For you?
For me, nothing. We could do supercuts too.
If you get in a, yeah. And these memes, there's probably tons of them. We only see a few of them on Conan and Jon Stewart. They do use this.
Make a note of that, Chad.
And Chad,
got it.
Get me an account.
Maybe we could spend the mug money on a SnapStream account.
There you go.
That's a good idea. Meanwhile, I know one thing we're not going to spend it on, trips to the post office. Time to talk about stamps.com. Go ahead, everybody, if you want to take a break, smoke them if you got them. The smoking lamp is lit, John. John likes to go out and have a stogie during these commercials. Stamps.com is a way to, you know what? It's a way to turn yourself into a mailing pro. This is not, I have to say, this is not for somebody who's just doing your Christmas card list. This is for somebody who does a lot of mailing. It's part of your business, whether you're sending out invoices and you use QuickBooks, if you're an eBay seller, an Amazon seller, a PayPal seller. You don't want to have to go to the post office, buy stamps, and put them on an envelope. No, that's for the amateurs, especially this time of year. You don't want to get in line there. Crazy at the post office. Stamps.com is a solution. Lets you print your own U.S. postage legally from your own computer, your own printer. You don't need a postage meter. Look at that new scale, Chad. We got to get the new scale.
I know. We have to get another account so we can get that new scale.
I already got two scales. I want a third.
I want the brushed aluminum scale that matches my iPad.
That is pretty. Looks thin.
That is amazing.
It is. It's kind of the scale air.
And you just get that.
Stamps free.
Oh, my gosh.
Free. So here's the deal. Go to stamps.com. If you do a mailing, this does all the things you want. You know, you send an email to the recipient saying, we just shipped. The mail carrier comes and gets. You can schedule free pickups so you don't have to worry about even mailing this stuff. They come and get it. It'll print postage on an envelope. It'll print packages. If you're doing international mailing, it fills out all the forms automatically, takes the data from the Amazon or eBay or PayPal or Etsy site or whatever, or from your QuickBooks. I mean, this really streamlines your mailing. It is the way to get more done faster, more affordably, because there's discounts you can't get at the post office. Now, if you go to stamps.com, you'll see that $80 offer. But I don't want you to do that, because if you click the upper right-hand corner, you'll find out why. 2 billion letters and packages have been sent with stamps.com. Put TWIT in the offer code. And now that $80 value. Now, by the way, I think you get the new scale. I don't think you get the old scale. We just have to update that picture.
I would hope so. I think so.
I think you get the new scale. You same old host, but you get the new scale.
Host hasn't changed.
The host is still going to look old. $55 in postage coupons. You get the digital scale. That's a $50 value. By the way, yours to keep. If you cancel at any time, you get to keep the scale. $5 supply kit and 4-week trial of stamps.com. All you have to do is click the radio microphone and enter in our offer code TWIT. Never go to the post office again. This is what the pros do. Stamps.com. We thank them for their support. Do you have a Newport, Salem?
Salem, don't inhale them.
John C. Dvorak. OMG. That's from Throwboy.
It matches the shirt.
Throwboy. Yeah, you can have that. You want that? Every time John comes here, you can't have the jewelry, by the way.
The jewelry's over here.
Okay, because I have to return that.
It's my wife's color.
Really? Let me ask Lisa. That is nice. You know what? I think Mimi would like that.
I think so.
Mm-hmm. But instead, she's getting the OMG pillow.
No, you're keeping this here. It's a good prop. I like to use it.
Moving right along.
I don't take anything home on this trip because there's nothing here.
There's nothing.
There's some bacon-flavored vodka in the back.
When it comes to alcoholic beverages, you are in the... Go in my cupboard there in the back of my office. Anything you want. Anything you like. You can even take the Dan Aykroyd autographed... skull-shaped vodka bottle.
I'm not going to take anything like that.
You could. This is how much I love you, John C. Dvorak. Google Chromebook selling like hotcakes.
Why?
Are you stunned, Tim?
A surprise for sure. I mean, they certainly hit a new low price point. We've got one at $200 and $250 for the Samsung.
But isn't it just like the netbook? I mean, didn't we learn that cheap computers are crappy computers?
Well, these are very, you know, high quality netbooks. But yeah, they definitely do look and feel like netbooks for sure. But they're thinner. The battery life is quite good on that Samsung, at least. And, you know, Google's making a new push right now. We were a little bit curious on what exactly Google was going to do with Chrome OS, because for a while there, they were quite quiet on that front. But then we get the new Samsung unit a few months ago, and then the new unit just dropped from Acer.
The Acer is kind of cheesy. According to your review, the Acer is kind of cheesy, but this Samsung's pretty nice.
The Samsung is absolutely very nice. It's, you know, on the very high end of the or the netbook specs for sure, almost crossing into the regular laptop territory. But there's also rumors of a touchscreen Chrome OS laptop coming sometime in the new year, perhaps directly made by Google itself with no partner at all, which would be very interesting. So we'll see what exactly Google is up to. It's a little bit confusing still with Android and Google TV and Chrome OS as well. We're trying to figure out exactly where Google is going with all these things. But Google did make a big push into small businesses and to the education market as well with leasing programs for these, which we thought was a great idea. And so I'm hoping that Google finds some success on that front, because I think that could be a really big win for them. If they can get these into schools, low-cost laptops that are, you know, very effortlessly connected to the internet, that could be a great thing.
You know, I somebody asked me about this. Oh, this Google Chromebook is really cheap. Should I get one? And I said, well, you know, it's not really, doesn't do anything. It's a netbook.
It's a browser.
It's a browser. And you have to be on the internet. So you have to be on the internet all the time to use it? I mean, are you useless? I said, yes, totally. He says, well, why would anybody buy one?
That's not totally useless anymore.
I can answer. Yeah, I can answer that question. The Chromebook is the computer for the rest of them. It's the computer you give to somebody else.
Yeah, according to the ad, it's for dogs and babies.
Dogs, babies, grandma, students, employees, anybody you want to lock into a cage.
And you
don't want to do tech support. You don't want to worry about anything. You don't want to let them install anything. Nothing. You give them a Chromebook and everybody's happy because they surf the web and do email and do all that kind of stuff. And you don't have to worry about anything. Like, you know, they advertise it by showing that you can destroy it. And if you destroy it, you just get another one.
Right.
Open it up, log in, and all your stuff is still there.
So yeah.
That's really the benefit. But nobody, besides Jeff Jarvis, I don't know of anybody who's actually chosen one for himself.
Jeff, who is our host on This Week in Google, has decided, but in his role as a journalist more than anything,
to
limit himself to a Chromebook.
Yeah, and Google stuff.
Yeah.
And he's probably working on that book
these days. Go ahead, Tim.
Because we use Google Docs or Google Drive now, for quite a few tools internally. And, you know, our CMS is, of course, all online. And we use an online wiki for sharing information. And, of course, almost all of us at Engadget use Gmail for our email tools. So because of that, I think it's very possible to actually do, you know, and be very productive with these machines. And you can work with them offline. You can edit docs offline and do some things offline with them, which does make them usable for long flights that don't have go-go internet, for example. But ultimately, they are very restrictive. Really, you can do so much online these days that it'd be a very good machine for somebody who's, like Mike was just saying, somebody who, you know, you don't want to worry about them getting a virus or downloading some toolbar for Firefox or something like that that's going to screw up their entire machine. It's a very easy machine to use and very hard to destroy.
$249, 11.6-inch display. Your review says 6.5-hour battery life. But it's running on ARM.
Right, and that's a big difference between the two that just came out. The Samsung one is running on ARM, which is the first, actually, and so it's got pretty good battery life. It's very thin, very efficient. The other one, the $200 one from Acer, is actually running on a Celeron processor. It's an x86 chip.
Yeah.
Battery life on that was about half that of the Samsung, which is, you know, very, very disappointing. And also, it doesn't have the 3G wireless connection built in that most of the Chromebooks do, which is, you know, a big advantage. You can get, usually it's 100 megs of data per month with those devices, or some small amount of data anyway, just enough to check your email and to download some docs and to do some simple web surfing. But you can do it from anywhere, which is a great advantage from these machines. The Acer doesn't have that. So that really is just a netbook that happens to be running Chrome OS, whereas the Samsung feels like a nice Chrome OS Chromebook laptop.
Even in Gadget Review, Miriam, is it Jouar? How do you pronounce Miriam's last name?
Miriam Jouar, yes.
Jouar says this will always be a polarizing class of product, and I think that's accurate. The geeks like us are going, "Wah!" But I think maybe you're right. Maybe some people that's all they need. It's always backed up because you're always in the cloud. Do you? Were you use
They're
Google
prisoners,
Docs?
Huh? Slaves?
Yeah, people, employees. what's interesting is, so you use Google Docs. We use Google Docs here.
Mm-hmm.
The one thing that concerns me a little bit about all of this is I've just recently learned about the Electronic Communications Protection Act, which Senator Leahy's trying to amend to be a little bit more up to date. But this thing was written in the 80s, 1986. And one of the things it says is it assumes that anything that's anything that's stored in the cloud that hasn't been accessed in 6 months.
Did you talk about this before?
Is public.
No, it's abandoned.
It's abandoned,
yeah.
Which means you don't need a search warrant to get it. All the government or an law enforcement has to do is get an administrative subpoena. They don't even have to prove illegality. They just have to say, yeah, this would be useful in an investigation.
Yeah, they
and
just
you
look at all the
and
old
so
stuff.
Everything
6 months, which is the crack up, because that's not nothing. I mean, you could if you look at your own email 6 months ago. I mean, there's still email I haven't answered. It's still active,
right? There's mostly email I haven't answered.
Well, in your case,
now Leahy is trying to amend this, and we'll see what happens. They just came out with an amendment that passed the Senate Judiciary Committee, and we did talk about this last week, but we got it reversed because some of the amendments were worse. But apparently, what Leahy's amendments are going to do is to amend that $180 day rule to say yes, you still need a warrant. However, law enforcement, and we have talked about this before, I just think it's worth saying again, can still get things like your name, address, credit card, bank information, the date and times of email, the recipients of the email, the devices you used when conducting electronic communications, all of that without any warrant.
Yeah.
It can all be done just with a pen register. Do you worry, Tim? Is there, corporately, do they worry at all about the idea that everything that's in those Google Docs is basically available to the feds anytime after 6 months?
You can actually get internet-provided instances of Google Docs, basically hosted instances of Google Docs. Not actually hosted, but you know, kind of walled off from the internet as a whole, which actually AOL has done.
Interestingly,
we don't actually use those. We're using the public Google Docs internally, adding gadgets so that we don't have to worry about the internet and VPN and all that fun stuff. Right. So there are ways for corporations to protect themselves from that sort of thing. And I presume that content that was protected like that would not be included in that, but perhaps not. But I personally don't tend to worry about that sort of thing. But then again, I try to do good on the internet, so maybe that means I shouldn't have to worry.
I think that that's a risky. If you're not doing anything illegal, what do you care?
That's a specious argument because that's not really what it's all about.
Sure,
it's about
fishing expeditions.
It's about fishing expeditions, entrapment, finding something you could blackmail somebody else with that may have
General Petraeus
may have an effect on you.
Let's say you don't like the director of the CIA, for instance. Maybe you'd like to get him out of office. If you could only go through his personal Gmail account, maybe you could find something really salacious.
It
worked out fine.
But I don't think that we should let fears like this keep us from using what is ultimately a very good service. And it sounds like the government is aware that this is a curious exception to the rule or wasn't an intended use of the rule and is trying to fix it. And I
what about encryption?
Do so.
You could use, but you can't, well, I guess.
Encryption works.
You could encrypt the doc and then save it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I mean, so are you doing that?
The mega uploads case.
That's the example. That's a perfect example.
Yeah.
Exactly. Because all of these innocent, there were thousands, millions of innocent people, just users, and they decided that the physical servers were evidence. And so they took them and, oh, gosh, there's data on the servers. We get to do anything we want with that data. I mean, you could even imagine a case in which you're using a legitimate service. Hackers steal all of the personal data. The feds go in and grab the servers from the hackers. And now the stuff that has been stolen by the hackers is now in the hands of who knows who in the government doing who knows what.
Right.
And it's really the biggest picture about this whole thing is something I've talked about on this show before, which is every time there's an advancement in technology, if you assume that the cloud is an advancement. There's this balance between the public's rights and the government's
desires.
Exactly. And they take advantage of all new technologies to seize more power as it relates to the public. Every cell phone thing, now the cloud, they're trying to get around the Constitution. They're trying to say, hey, here's an opportunity for us just to have no rules about who's about searches, basically. This is a constitutional issue. And it's like, it's yet another case, and people are not sufficiently up in arms about it. It's the principle of the thing. We can't let governments seize additional power over the population every time there's an advancement in technology, because there's going to be a million more.
Hear, hear.
Hear, hear. Bravo.
I absolutely agree, by the way. But do you propose that we not use these services until the laws are up to speed with the technology?
I propose that we talk about this and get people riled up so that they understand that their rights are being trampled, and exactly what's happening. I mean, we just, we still have a democracy, and if people make enough noise about it, then we will have laws that protect us from, invasive, crap like this. I mean, it's something people should be concerned about.
They should be, but unfortunately, they're more concerned about dogs having their own social network.
But John, shouldn't? Well, should isn't they? It time?
Dogs have. I think it is time. Dog book.
Actually, Dogster was like 3 weeks after Friendster. There was Dogster, right? You remember that?
Yeah, vaguely. And Catster. I remember
Dogster. Dogs have had their own social network as long as we have. And do they use it, Ozzy?
They can't type.
They can't type their little paws.
A dog's social network is they sniff the behind of the other dog.
That's a social network.
That's their Facebook. It's not that different, actually.
No, it goes on in San Francisco a lot.
I'm just going to stop talking right now.
Okay. So what's the next topic on the agenda?
I want to talk about Windows 8, but first, is 40 million really good? But first,
40 million what?
They say Microsoft said it's the fastest selling version of Windows ever.
Nobody else says this.
I know. Where do they get that number from? We'll talk about it in a second. I know. It's different. It's maybe a PR web. They're going to be the butt of
Balmer
a joke
web.
For Balmer web. Hey, that's a good idea. TWiT web. Our show today brought to you by our friends at Citrix. If you're in IT, this is a tool. Everybody in IT has, their tools that they use, everything from a utility tool, your own little, what do they call those? The Gerber tool to every IT guy I know has a Gerber
Leatherman?
Tool. A Leatherman on their belt or Gerber. That's another kind.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah.
My Leatherman was confiscated by the TSA years ago.
Of course, you can't bring that through. What are you, crazy?
This was at the beginning. Who knew?
Who knew? But there's also software tools, not just hardware tools. And I got this is the multi-tool for the IT pro online. It's called GoToAssist. Have you used this? Number one in remote support, but let me tell you, Citrix is making this better and better all the time. It is the number one remote support tool for IT. 10 years in business, but they've added new features, two new features that I think are fantastic. So there's GoToAssist remote access. They've just added GoToAssist service desk, which is a tracking system. You need this, right, to track and resolve issues. So it's cloud-based service management tools, easy to deploy, easy to use, ticket and incident management, problem management, changes, releases, all of that stuff available. And now they also have remote monitoring. They've really beefed this up. If you haven't looked at GoToAssist lately, you got to give it a try. The monitoring is awesome. You put the crawler on your client's network. This is great if you want to be a managed service provider. You want to grow as an IT professional. Or if you can get the boss to pay for this, it's going to save your life if you're in a company doing hardware or software support. You run the crawler on the network. It finds every bit of hardware, all the computers, but also the network-attached devices, and I really like this, all the software. You get an essay of everything on your network. You'll have this whole, database of this stuff. And then they've got a dashboard, and you could set up trackers. They have some standardized dashboards, but you can also custom trackers, all kinds of stats. Everything from, how is the Wi-Fi performance to what is the average disk utilization? What is the toner cartridge doing? And the reason you do this is because you can have proactive alerts, text messages, email messages, instant messages that let you know if there's a problem. As you set up the alert yourself if you want, using customized thresholds, or you can have the preset thresholds. And if, disk space falls below 5% on a computer, you will get an alert. And you can be proactive. You can fix that problem before it becomes a big problem. This really is the way to do support. So they've got the ticket management. They've got the remote
support, and they've got the monitoring now. And you could try all of it free for 30 days if you visit GoToAssist.com. We actually use it here. I have it on all the servers, so I don't have to come in if I want to fix something. I use the remote support a lot, but I know that Russell Tammany, our IT guy, is very interested in the monitoring module. Visit GoToAssist.com, click the Try It Free button, and the promo code for this is TWIT. You have to click an extra link to make that in there. Please put that in there so we get credit. And you can try this for 30 days. You get to try all three, the remote support, the service desk, and the monitoring module, free for 30 days. Please give it a try. I think you're going to like this. GoToAssist.com from those great folks at Citrix. Oh, look, here's all the jewelry. I just found the inventory. Let's see, yeah, see if there's something you like.
Well, there's the that thing.
Right, I like there. This. This is like a wedding ring that's actually a belt.
Yeah, yeah, that's a good one.
No, I like that.
Yeah, I
it's kind of cute. It's got a little belt buckle on it. It's cute. Anyway,
I think you should get one.
First, I have to.
Yeah,
get
there
married.
It is. This is the thing. This is,
yeah, how much? Nothing. It's $200 normally. TWIT price $146.
Huh?
You know what? I'll buy it for you, and you can give it to Mimi.
I think that's she'd appreciate that.
Be a good pinky ring. We got to get her size though, because you got to make sure it fits.
Yeah.
Although I don't mind it.
This gold though, so it shouldn't be.
It's 14 karat.
You can pound it. You can make it fit.
You can make it fit. No, wait a minute. I'm sorry. This is 5 1/3 karat amethyst. That's how big that is. Look at that. Diamonds, and it's sterling silver with yellow rhodium plating. That's why it looks like gold. It's sterling.
Okay.
Isn't that interesting?
Yeah, it's fascinating.
Windows. Oh, first of all, let's talk about Scroogled, because you talked a little. I think, was it you that wrote about this? Oh, no, Harry McCracken wrote about this. I thought maybe Mike Elgan wrote about it. Harry McCracken said, come on. But I just like the name Scroogled. Have you go to Scroogled.com, John. Have you seen this?
Well, there used to be a different Scroogle.
So here's the deal on Scroogled.
There used to be a search engine called Scroogle.
Yeah,
it really?
Was. Yeah, it was a Google. It was a shell on a Google search engine. Eliminate all advertising.
Oh,
and then Google got on their case and pulled it.
Then Microsoft came along and said, "We'll take that domain. Thank you very much." So this poor woman, she's clearly worried about what Google might be doing with their Google Shopping. Microsoft says Google Shopping, which used to be just a search engine.
I like the look on her face.
Wait a minute. There's another guy. He's even more worried. Wait, let's scroll down.
She looks constipated.
He just looks mad. And I don't know what the four fingers are, but I think in Italian that means...
It means something.
To the devil with you.
He's been Scroogled four times.
Maybe that's what... But it's kind of... All they're upset about is the fact that Google Shopping, which used to be unpaid search results, are now all paid search results.
Here's the thing. They're actually better search results in my experience.
So I went to Scroogle and I got this.
Than the unpaid ones.
Yeah, I did some back-to-back comparisons after this to see if Microsoft really had a point. And so I searched for things on Bing Shopping and on Google Shopping as well. And by and large, the results were far better on Google than on
Ironic.
Bing. I searched for a 64 gig micro SD card, for example. The top result on Google was a Kensington option, which was reasonably priced. I think it was from Amazon. The one at Bing was the price was low, and so I clicked through, and it was a $50 shipping charge from this one vendor I'd never heard of. That was selling it through Bing for a $40 micro SD card with a $50 shipping charge, and they were out of stock, so it really shouldn't have even shown up anyway. But ultimately, my experiences have been that Google Shopping, even if they are a little bit skewed, are still better results than Bing's, unfortunately.
The point,
one of the funny things about Microsoft is that the different divisions never talk to each other. They're like they're all at war with each other all the time, and so Microsoft's Bing actually has exactly this sort of thing, paid placements for the holidays. And so that was a project that no doubt was happening over here. And then the Scroogled project was happening over there. And they didn't talk to each other. So now Microsoft is slamming Google for something Microsoft is doing.
It's hilarious.
Ouch.
It's hilarious. Never a dull moment.
Microsoft just can't stop shooting themselves in the foot. Now, they said... 40 million Windows 8 licenses in the first month, which is comparable to the Windows 7.
Now, are these upgrade licenses or are these just sales? Because if they have this as a license thing automatic when you buy a new machine, that's what the monthly sales could be.
It's a very good question, John. Unfortunately, it could be all they're kinds not answering. Of
things. Yeah.
Right. Is it explained?
It could be all kinds of things. It could be stores. It could be OEMs. It could be, you know.
Yeah, filling the channel. Like,
yes, it could be bulk license purchases as well. Unfortunately, they haven't actually clarified what exactly this 40 million number means, but it is significantly higher than they said is comparable to Windows 7, which was 60 million over 2 months versus 40 million in 1 month. But I was starting to remember, do you guys remember what the upgrade prices were for Windows 7 at launch?
Well, that's the difference.
$100.
Yeah, it was like $130.
These are 40 buckers.
And it's cheap. Yeah. Windows 8 is the cheapest version of Windows ever.
Right.
$40.
So more ways than one, I might add.
Yeah.
Why not?
There's another piece of data from NPD Group, which points out that since the Windows 8 launch, about 40% of the PCs being sold are not running Windows 8. They're running an older version. And that's they can actually compare that to Windows 7, which was 83%. So by that measure, the percentage of PCs that have the newest operating system is significantly sucking badly compared to the last version.
If I'm going to buy a new PC, I'm going to request Windows 7 on it. I don't want a new – and I'm talking about a desktop. Yeah, if I have a touch screen laptop, I'll get Windows 8. But if I'm going to buy a desktop from scratch
today – They make
right touch today,
screen – Dell's XPS 1 with Windows 8 is touch screen.
I don't like to be that close inches to the screen.
Well, you don't have to. You just reach out and swipe it.
I got to reach out and it's like it hangs your arm. You're going to end up with –
But you don't spend – you don't keep – so here – I'm playing devil's advocate because I'm not sure I'm convinced of this. But I do think touch is nice if you – it's a hybrid environment. So most of the time you're typing along. But haven't you ever done that where you've been using your iPad for a while, and so you reach out and you try to swipe a screen? There's just times when you want to do that.
I was watching somebody with one of these touchscreen desktops, and a fly landed on the screen.
Yeah.
Started setting off all kinds of things.
No,
the next
flies
thing you know, the guy
that
was the fly
can,
was
I've
typing.
As well.
Flies can do that?
They can, absolutely. I've had that happen as well.
It said, "Help me."
Help me.
It's using the virtual keyboard to talk to you, yeah.
So flies work with capacitive screens.
They are fully conductive.
It's buggy software.
You both of you say you've seen this.
I have seen this.
This fly was typing a URL.
There's a video on YouTube of it, actually, if you want to see it happening. But I've seen it in the real world.
Wow. Is it time for flies to have their own social network?
I think so, yes. Flies should have their own social network.
So I have the Windows RT, and I think it's kind of interesting. It's not perfect, but it's an interesting. So the Surface.
I played with yours. I like it.
Yeah.
I was at the airport, and Microsoft's doing a good thing here. They're putting these pop-up, not a store, but a pop-up events at the airport.
That's what Google did for its Chromebook, so they're doing it too.
Yeah, huh? And then you go in there and you can play around. They give you a free $25 coupon just to play with the thing, and you get $25 off your next Southwest flight.
Wow.
Seemed like a deal to me.
Google was doing that in Terminal 2. If you got on a Virgin America flight, they'd say, well, take a Chromebook with you.
Oh, they didn't do that.
And you can watch a movie, and then they had it at the other end. You'd drop it off.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. Huh. Something about airports, I guess. It's a captive audience. Microsoft did announce that they're going to sell their Surface Pro. So this is the one we were talking about was the RT. It's the ARM-based. It's the tablet.
Yeah, I like it.
The Pro is Windows 8 Professional. It's like full Windows 8. That's going to be $899 for the 64-gigabyte model, $999 for the 128-gigabyte model. That's without keyboard.
I wrote a column about this saying this is way overpriced. I think a lot of people would agree with that, and it's.
But you get a pen, a
no,
Surface pen.
I don't think you do. I don't think you do. I think both the pens and keyboards are sold separately. I think.
Yeah. I know you don't get the keyboard. But I thought you got a pen. Well, who cares? Who uses a pen anyway? It's an i5. It's a 1920x1080, so it's a good resolution for a 10.6-inch screen. It's got a full-size USB 3 port. A mini display port on it. The pen, I guess, I don't know if it's what kind of digitizer. Do you know, Tim, if it's like a pressure sensitive or if it's a stylus?
I don't know. We haven't had a chance to actually see this in the wild yet, so I don't know exactly what
alone.
It's using. But I presume it's similar to what the Galaxy Note is using, which is kind of a Wacom-based technology,
right,
which does have pressure sensitivity. So it's definitely a capacitive pen. And I'm pretty sure that it is actually included, but the keyboard or the touch cover, those are not included.
So pen input and pen included with purchase. Yeah, that's right. And it is a capacitive pen. Well, it'd have to be because it's a capacitive screen.
Right.
But battery life will be one half the RT. So we're talking, what, 4 hours?
4 to 4.5, yep.
Yep. Is that enough to make that a compelling product? What's interesting is I would have said no right now initially because I thought, well, all of these other companies are going to be putting out their Windows 8 Pro computers. There's some beautiful ones. I just saw one from Acer. But, boy, if you go to Best Buy or even a Microsoft store, there's a dearth of Windows 8 Pro computers.
They just came out.
Well, okay, remember Windows 7? There were lots of them. There's lots of announcements, but there are not a lot of them in the store.
Well, if I had a store, I wouldn't be inventorying them until I saw what was going to happen.
Yeah, and you know that Microsoft's going to have this Surface, and then maybe that would slow the OEMs down a little bit, waiting to see how that goes.
So somebody said they were watching one of these Surface machines on an airport on the tray, and apparently that little kickstand thing is positioned poorly, and it keeps falling off the edge of the tray.
Oh, you know what? That makes sense, because if you've got the touch cover or the type cover, I should have tried this. I didn't try this. I didn't take it out during the flight. But I bet you in economy that it's just a little too long to fit on the tray.
Yeah.
The weight is all in the very back.
Yeah.
And if that slips off the edge, down it goes. The bigger story here, I think, is that, I mean, let's just call a spade here. Windows 8, the Surface Pro, and Windows RT are flops.
Are they?
Disappointing failure. Yeah, they are. I've heard that RT, they cut in half the number they expected to sell. It's a flop, but it's actually not a terrible thing. Microsoft's trying to do something very tricky and difficult here. They know we're heading for a post-PC world. They know we're heading for a world where everything is touch. And they're the legacy company. They can't be like Apple and just cut everybody off at the knees and just go on to the next thing. And sorry, if you've invested a lot of money in this other stuff, we're going to the new thing. Microsoft is the company that tries not to do that. So they're trying to backward compatible support everything, all that kind of stuff. So how do they get all these reluctant global people to move into the post-PC world? Or more to the point, how do they avoid getting left behind and represent the past, the GUI interface, while Microsoft owns the future, which is the touch interface? So they're playing a funky game. And in hindsight, it appears that the better strategy would have been to have a Windows 8 that doesn't have the Metro UI, and then have devices that do have the Metro UI, and let consumers pick, and just not force it down people's throats. I think the biggest problem is this touch interface when people use it on a device that is not being used for touch. If you're using a mouse and a keyboard with something with an interface designed for touch, you're going to be disappointed, confused, annoyed, etc. And that's exactly what I think is happening with a lot of people. So, you know, I think the longer game, I think 3-4 years from now, 5 years from now, this is all going to be cool stuff. Microsoft, which I think is actually really good at making hardware. I think they're better at making hardware than they are at making software, ironically.
That's ironic because this is the first PC they've ever made.
Exactly. And if you think about it, they've
made prototypes.
Right.
Well, right, but they've been making Xbox, which is a PC, really. I mean, they've been making peripheral device for a long time. But they, you know, if you look at the Windows RT, this device was not perfect at all. But wow, for a 1.0 release, a hardware product by a software company, was pretty darn good. So I think by the time they get to version 3 or something like that, it's probably going to be pretty good. So
Windows, you know, Blue, the upgrade, Windows Blue.
Yeah.
My argument is always that we have to understand Microsoft by understanding the retail strategy, which is where they're headed. They're following Apple's strategy because of the great margins per square foot sales that Apple has at their stores, the highest that any retail outlets ever achieved, much higher than Tiffany. And Microsoft saw this, and even if they get half the sales of an Apple store, they're still going to make more money than a Tiffany store. And they are going to push this as far as they can, but they have to have hardware in the stores. That's where they're going to bring out hardware, whether people liked it or not. We've been on this show years ago and said, oh, Microsoft will never do hardware. And I've always said they will do hardware because they've always been toying with it, and the Xbox is a good example of hardware.
You were the one, though, and I quote you all the time, who said, well, look at Apple's strategy and Microsoft's strategy. Apple sells hardware, Microsoft sells software. And you always said, well, whose wallet would you rather have, Steve Jobs or Bill Gates? And for a long time, it was Bill Gates' wallet. They were making the money, but that has flipped. You must have known.
I saw them. Somehow, no, I didn't know anything. All happen. I knew is that when they started doing the retail stores, you had to say, why are they doing this? And what's the structure of their right. of the future based on these stores? And then once you get the numbers from Apple, you go, oh, my God, would Microsoft be crazy not to do these stores? But you can't do the stores the way they did with their experimental store in San Francisco, which was just sell software. Right. You have to have stuff in there for people to play with.
That was a terrible store. The one at the Metreon, you'd go in there, there was just boxes terrible. Of software.
It was terrible. But these
That's
new
exactly
stores
right.
are...
Yeah. Yeah, I'm sorry to interrupt you, John, but I just want to agree with you. That's exactly right. Everybody's going into these Microsoft stores today. It's almost all Xbox people, or right. at least the people who are buying
right
stuff. They're buying Xbox stuff right, exactly right now. And this is the Apple's magic strategy with retail. The thing that's great about it is that it's a gateway drug. Originally, you had an iPod, and you go in there to see if there was a case for your iPod, and you'd see the other stuff. Now you have an iPhone. All these Windows users have an iPhone. They go in there and they see the iMac and they're like, wow. You know, and they go in there 20 times. And at the 21st time, they're like, you know what? Screw it. I'm going to get an iMac. You know, that's the real power of the Apple Store. And that's what Microsoft needs to do. They need to convert all these Xbox freaks and all the whatever fans they have and convert them over to their other stuff.
Is there an Xbox likewise, Halo effect? Ha, get it? Halo?
I get it.
Very funny.
No, I think they're going to bring out. They're going
to
bring.
They're trying to get there with the smart glass technology that's built into Surface and to Windows 8 as well. They're trying to kind of ooze that Xbox experience over to their other devices, and I think that could be successful for them. But to kind of take the coolness of the brand Xbox and to displace the rather uncoolness of Windows is a big ask.
Well, but they will have this Surface is one of these things that I've seen people do it. They played with it at the airport and they talked about it on the airplane. They really liked it, and I think once Microsoft they're spending the extra money to make these things cooler than a normal Microsoft product, and I think once they get a couple more machines and a phone, they have to have a phone company that they're going to either buy Nokia or somebody else so they can have a phone you can buy there, and all the rest of it, people can walk into a Microsoft store and have almost an Apple experience.
It's soup to nuts.
And it's cheaper. It's going to be cheaper than the Apple stuff, and the stores are clones. They're a little bigger.
I think that
it's going to be fun to watch.
My experience with Windows RT was exactly that, which is when you first start playing with it, it's like, oh, this is cool, this is nice, this is great. But it's when you live with it for a while, as I did.
You tried.
It doesn't satisfy. There's
what's wrong with it?
It's rough edged. And it's hard to discover some of the ways to get to control panels and stuff when you're using a real application like Office. You end up going to desktop. And then touch doesn't work quite as well. For instance, you can, let's say you're using Excel on a Surface RT. Yeah, you can open up the cells to make them bigger, but the menus and all the touch targets on the menus and the ribbon are all still
dinky,
and you can't hit them. And it's just little things like that where you go, this on the surface, so to speak, this looks great. It feels great. You go, this is innovative. This is exciting. And it's when you live with it for a little bit. And now maybe that's not a bad thing, because maybe people will buy it. And, you know, Paul Thurrott, who is certainly an expert on Windows, the host of our Windows Weekly, wrote the article on his winsupersite.com that uncertainty could turn Windows 8 into the next Vista.
Well, there is the theory that every other operating system Microsoft has done, and I think you can trace this back, has been a dog, and then they rush out a new one.
He says sales of Windows 8 are well below Microsoft's internal projections and have been described, according to his sources inside the company, as disappointing. They're blaming, though, lackluster PC maker designs and lack of availability, which is what I was talking about, which may be one reason why Surface is more important even than we realized. He says, one of my trusted sources at Microsoft confirmed Windows 8 weak start, and with all the drama surrounding Windows 8 and the recent unexpected departure of Steven Sinofsky, the Windows chief, rumors are sure to swirl. One, Microsoft's blaming the PC makers. Two, people are worried about Sinofsky and the handoff to Julie Larson Green.
The ribbon girl.
Also, it's a bad economic times, and that could hurt sales for anything, right? If you're happy, if you're a business, I don't feel any urge or pressure at all to upgrade my PC.
I still have one machine running XP.
Yeah, a lot of most people do. And the confusion over whether Windows 8 is a tablet, is it a desktop, what is it?
Well, I think it was ill-conceived. I mean, Microsoft has this history of having various devices trying to all look and feel the same, and they began by taking the Windows desktop as a complete system and trying to take it down a few notches. And so the early smartphones, the original smartphone, as a matter of fact, and some of these other pocket computers had Windows shrunk onto that platform with a pen, and you had the same icons you had on your Windows OS, and it was like it ran Word and things, and it was a downscale. And so somewhere, but it never worked out. So somewhere along the line, someone said, why don't we do the opposite and go upscale? We start with a phone OS and then move it upscale.
That's what they did.
Which they believed Apple was going to do because they had suggested they might, but they never did.
Move iOS to the desktop.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, or back to the Mac, as they called it.
Right. But they never did yet. And I don't know if they will. So Microsoft jumped the gun on this, and they upscaled from a phone OS to a PC OS. It's ridiculous. It was idiotic, and it's not what anybody wants. I don't want a phone OS on a 27-inch monitor, so when I click on something, I get full screen that's on a 27-inch monitor of one
Apple
app.
Apple is kind of moving that way, though.
Yeah, well, you haven't seen it yet, though.
Yeah. Well, the irony
is that Microsoft owns the large touchscreen market. They have the original,
yeah, the big giant ones.
Right, and they also purchased Perceptive Pixel, which was the other company. It was these between the two of them. That's a lot of intellectual property, a lot of brilliant research that's been done, and they're kind of doing nothing with it. I mean, you know, what Ballmer 3 years ago promised that there'd be a consumer version of Surface, again, the big retail touchscreen thing that they have. I didn't know it was going to be what they now call Surface. I thought we were going to have the big, you know, consumer touchscreen, and that would be absolutely awesome. But I, you know, the other point I want to make about the stores and Windows 8 and about the thing you talked about, Leo, where it doesn't really feel right, things are hidden, it's non-intuitive, and so on, all completely true. They're so busy copying Apple that I think they need to get their act together and start copying Google. So what would Google do, to paraphrase Jeff Jarvis? Google would use the stores as a laboratory as an ongoing focus group to see what people are confused about when they're poking around on these machines. They would have a camera above every single device, and they would see, look, everybody's always confused about this, that, and the other thing, and have that be like, you know, you literally have millions of users telling you exactly what's wrong with your user interface. And they really should use stores like that. They should use them as data gathering engines.
Well, for all we know, they are. I mean, they may be asking their associates, hey, what are people confused about? Although I don't think that's Microsoft's way. I think Microsoft's much more about chest beating and saying, it's selling great, it's selling great. Paul wraps up his article saying, the net effect of all of these concerns is it contributes to a wait-and-see approach with Windows 8. And I think that's definitely what people are saying. He says this is exactly the opposite of what Microsoft should want at this time. In this way, Windows 8 is much like that. The launch is much like that of Vista, where a nagging, and in that case, tech blogger-led cabal of disappointed voices. I love this. He's a good writer.
Yeah, he's funny.
A nagging cabal of disappointed voices dominated the discussion at launch and torpedoed the product before it had a chance. You agree?
Yeah.
It's kind of what's happening.
Yep. I'm reminded of I don't know why Microsoft, this whole thing is somewhat baffling to me.
What Paul's always said is Microsoft, it's a bobble on Microsoft's part. They just don't seem to handle this stuff well.
They're not a social company. They don't listen to the users. They don't listen to the critics. Right. They don't listen to anybody pretty much. They do their own thing.
The problem is that they need to fire Steve Ballmer. He's out of his depth. Yeah. And they need a visionary guy.
I hate to say it, but I think the problem is who.
Right. I mean, yeah. Ballmer's going to quit one of these days, and it's probably going to be, you know, within the next few years, I'm guessing. But who could run that company? It's a monster company. I think what they should do, I don't think they should fire Steve Ballmer. I think they should divide the company into four separate operations, spin out the stock. Before. I say it all the time. Yeah. It should be four. It used to be three companies. Now I think they can do four.
What? Consumer?
Consumer, Xbox, gaming, enterprise with the mail and all the rest of it. People love that Exchange server. And I think there was the fourth one was maybe retail would be one
retail.
Of them. But I mean, there's different ways to divide it up. But the company's too big, and as you said earlier in the show, when we went on the Scroogled thing, it's like they got this. They're complaining about what Google's doing, and they're doing it at the same time, but because they can't communicate, the company is too unwieldy.
Yeah.
And Ballmer can take the one company he likes.
You know, we'll find out December 6th. Tim Cook. Maybe Brian Williams will ask Tim Cook this question: who should take over Microsoft? Tim Cook will be. This would never have happened in the Steve Jobs era. Tim Cook has given a full interview to Brian Williams on his, what is it called, The Rock show?
Rock, it's called Rock Center.
Rock Center.
Yeah.
Yeah. He apparently was, they did a little tour of the Grand Central store, the Apple store in Grand Central.
Oh, the new one.
Yeah. And Brian Williams said that unlike Steve Jobs, Tim Cook was able to walk across Grand Central Station completely unrecognized. Of course he was.
Yeah.
Who knows who Tim Cook is? Once we got to the Apple store, he said that all changed as devoted fans approached him and treated him like a rock star. There he is, if you look at the video, walking across completely unrecognized. No flash mobs to greet him. No happy fans.
And nobody throwing a pie at him.
Nobody hit him with a pie either. So there's the
nobody caring about Brian Williams either.
Well, that's a good point. They didn't even notice Brian Williams. Well, without the cameras. Anyway, this was taped, I guess, a few days ago, and will air next week, December 6th. What is that? That's soon.
It looks like they should take out an ad. I mean, this to me is just a publicity stunt for Apple. Like, congratulations on getting a job well done.
Yeah, but it's just. But that's one of the things that is different. A Steve Ballmer interview is not going to be something that normal people are interested in, but Tim Cook, people are very interested in Apple.
Mm.
Mm.
Mm. He's a boring guy.
Tim Cook, yeah.
Yeah. So he's a piece of wood.
Yeah.
Well, he's an operations guy. He's the guy who invented, last in, first out kind of, the inventory program that he saves a lot of money.
Yeah, he talks like a politician. He doesn't really ever go out on any sort of thing. A good CEO
does that. It's the Eric Schmidts and the Steve Jobs of the world that are good for us, but I think bad for their companies. Don't you think?
Yep. I don't think Schmidt's bad.
Well, Schmidt would say stuff.
Well, he does. He's got a, yeah, he's a...
He would say stuff that really increased the creepy factor.
He still says weird stuff once
He still says weird stuff. Now, that makes good copy.
I like him.
For all of us. I like him.
I've always liked the guy.
But I don't think it's good for the company. I think Larry.
Well, he's not.
How many interviews is Larry Page doing?
Zero.
These days? Zero. Yeah. He's smart. A good CEO gets out of the.
No, his excuse was he couldn't talk at all. Remember that for what months and
but
months.
He can now. His voice is back.
Perfect CEO.
Perfect CEO has no voice. Although Jobs was the exception that proves the rule because Jobs was very good marketer. He was
and manipulating
marketer.
The media.
And he totally manipulated the media. He played Walt Mossberg like a royal flush.
Well, Mossberg wasn't the only one that was on his speed dialer.
Yeah. We're going to take a break, come back with more. Amazon looking for $3 billion in loans. Would you lend money to Amazon?
Yeah.
All right. Apparently you're not alone. And well, you might not want to leave your laptop in the hotel room anymore, but first, let's see what we missed this week. If you missed TWiT...
On TWiT, i5 for the iPhone.
Do you have time?
Christmas Music Radio is $1.99, and you really need to want to listen to Christmas music for it to be worth it at all to you. There are free alternatives in the App Store, but honestly, they all seem pretty terrible. And if you hate Christmas and want me to stop talking about it, your wish is granted, Ebenezer.
Windows Weekly.
Are you using your Surface not on power?
Right now, no.
In other words, it's not. See, that's the problem you have.
It keeps going to sleep.
The Surface that's not plugged in is like an iPad. It turns off like every 10 seconds.
Constantly. So you notice that I'm constantly tapping the top.
That's why I asked. So if you plug that thing in, you can change the power setting so it stays online. That's what I do with mine because it drives me crazy how often it turns off.
Gizwiz.
Yeah. Boy, look at that. See a blue... Completely depilated.
Wow. Boy, oh boy.
But there is... Smell that.
That is right.
The burning means it's working.
NSFW.
I want a big star, Brian. That's why we got our old pal. Ladies and gentlemen, you know him from such shows as Heroes and Felicity. Ladies and gentlemen, Greg Grunberg.
Woo!
Put that music back on. Put that music back on.
Oh, sure. Here, I'll play the curse belt music for you again. There you go. There it is. Done.
TWiT. Just add water.
Holy crap. House ads. House ads. Hey, is Tom Merritt back there? Let's do something that's realistic and get a... Tom Merritt. Tom, you got some sort of news coming up for this week? Tom?
Hey, Leo, thanks. Here's a look at some of the stories we'll be keeping an eye on in the week ahead on Tech News Today. Monday, December 3rd, the International Telecommunications Union starts their 12-day conference in Dubai. They're just going to do something like determine the fate of the internet at that. But Tuesday, December 4th, Dark Knight Rises is out on Blu-ray. Thursday, December 6th, Apple and Samsung discuss their post-trial motions and injunction requests in court. That's from the patent trial from last summer. Also, Gadget Live happens in San Francisco. And the Neo Geo console is reborn. The cartridge console has its worldwide release date. Friday, December 7th, the Nintendo Wii Mini exclusive to Canada comes out for $100. And Saturday, December 8th, the Nintendo Wii U launches in Japan, along with the TV service in Japan only. That's a look at the week ahead. Back to you, Leo.
Thank you, Tom Merritt. I got some booze for you, John. You can have the Crystal Head Vodka, signed by Dan Aykroyd. I actually accidentally smudged the signature at one point, so it just says Aykroyd. Or the King Cake Lucky Player Imported King Cake Flavor Vodka from New Orleans in Connerval's coming up. So make sure you tune in TNT with Tom Johnson way over there. I was going to do a gag with him about liquor, but I guess it's not going to work. Hey. TNT every Monday through Friday, 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern time, 2100 UTC for your daily dose of tech news. Which do you want? Do you want the King Cake flavored vodka or what's in this bottle? Careful, the Dan Aykroyd signature's on the back.
It's getting all smudged up.
I know.
What are you giving it away?
I didn't know it was signed when I took the bottle out of the box and I realized I... You know, I feel bad. I actually have slighted Dan Aykroyd twice. We were going to have him on TWiT. This is back in the old studio. Oh. And he called in, but I didn't have the volume turned up on the phone.
Oh, no.
And he was sitting there for like 10 minutes going, Hello? I felt terrible. Dan Aykroyd. I felt terrible. Ghostbusters.
Should we have him on another episode?
We could try again. What do you got the Angry Birds for? Yeah. All right. So Amazon kind of went out to the markets and raised $3 billion selling bonds for the first time in 15 years. According to the SEC filing, Amazon will use the proceeds for general corporate purposes. That means we can spend it on anything we want.
Yeah, jet.
Could be, but may not, include repayment of debt, repurchase of outstanding shares of stock, acquisitions,
jet,
investments, working capital, investments in our subsidiaries, and capital expenditures. One possible use is the purchase of the company's headquarters for more than $1.1 billion. You know who owns that campus in the Seattle
Microsoft?
Area? Paul Allen.
Oh.
He needs $1 billion like he needs a hole in the head.
Well, that's how he makes his money.
Would you loan? Amazon currently has more than $5 billion in cash and very little debt. Would you lend Amazon money?
Yeah, who wouldn't? I think Jeff Bezos is a genius.
I do think he's a genius.
Yeah.
But I think also tough times might be ahead.
Well, there's going to be tough times for everybody else then, and I think Amazon will have the edge because there's if you talk about low price and convenience.
You know, I just read an article talking about Prime loses them a ton of money. You know that.
Good. I'm a Prime member. It's fine with me.
Well, so many things that Amazon does lose money. Their tablets lose money. Prime loses money. They really keep it close to the... They invest everything into future business. It's really amazing that they have any cash at all, actually.
Yeah. Okay, now
they're losing
that
money
works,
on every sale, but they're making it up in volume.
That works for a while. Doesn't after a while... So here's the deal with Prime. They took a write-down of, I think, $400 million on shipping last year, and it's presumed that much of that was Prime. I just read an article let me see if I can find this. This is from NPR, so actually, I guess it was audio, but
People, by the way, somebody in the chat room is going to short, or they'd short Amazon. This has like been tried. And the problem is, they fail.
You got to short them for a long time. You don't know when it's going to turn.
You get pulled out. I mean, eventually you get squeezed out, you're short, you're getting no money.
So Prime for $79 a year, and I'm a member, you're a member.
Everybody's a member.
Tim is, are you a Prime? Of course you're a Prime.
Lots of Amazon boxes surrounding my feet right now.
So it's a brilliant strategy because it means you go to Amazon first because you're going to get free two-day shipping.
Yeah, which is great.
On not everything, on many things. So NPR did a little survey trying to figure out, well, actually, this is according to the Wall Street Journal, what the most expensive shipping could be that you're saving money on. And it's a 1,500-pound gun safe that you could buy.
Wow.
And on Amazon.com. And the shipping would be free on this. Costs Amazon, I think, several hundred dollars. Well, we don't know because Amazon may have a special deal. But
no, they have a special deal. There's no doubt about
that. So the Canon safe, the CO54 Commander Series, premium 90-minute fire safe in gloss champagne.
It's a beauty.
Weighs 3/4 of a ton.
Wow. Nice.
And shipping is free because it's Amazon Prime.
Can you imagine the, do you get it in 2 days?
Yes.
Imagine somebody driving up with that thing.
It costs $3,699 for the safe on
Amazon.
Leave
it on the porch.
Leave it on the porch. Good luck moving it.
Now, if you buy it from Optics Planet, if you don't buy a Prime, it costs $1,100 to ship it. But if you get it from Amazon Prime,
$1,100.
Save $1,100 on shipping. So the point is that Amazon's losing almost $500 million a year on shipping costs, according to their own. So, where do you make that up? How do you make that up? It's not. Do you think that they're making so much money from the people who are shipping toilet paper?
I have no idea how they're making
it. The worst case scenario is that they, and this is kind of mirrored in their book publishing industry. The worst case scenario, the darkest or most negative spin on this is that they're trying to run everybody else out of business.
Yeah.
And that's where you make it up. When you're the last guy standing, then you make it up. When you're the last source of books and the last source of stuff that can be shipped, then you can charge anything you want. That's probably unfair, but
it's illegal in some cases, it's dumping in some cases, right?
Yes, I mean it feels that way in a lot of cases. In publishing, it certainly does.
Netscape accuse Microsoft of because it was giving away Internet Explorer of doing the very same thing? Didn't Intel get in trouble for that? I mean, this is in the European Union. They paid a huge fine. This is you sell below cost.
They're not selling below cost though. They're selling cheap. But they're not selling below cost.
Well, the shipping is below cost.
Sure they are. So they're selling books below cost in many cases, and they're selling tablets below cost. Who knows if they're losing money? You know, if you take a bath on shipping, sounds like they're selling that safe below cost.
By the way,
the issue of dumping is only for international stuff. It doesn't account domestically.
It's not just for Prime members.
That's true.
You can get that if you don't want it in 2 days. Even if you're not a Prime member, you get the free Super Saver shipping. So it's free shipping on that thing, no matter what.
And there's also the Prime streaming video, too. Reed Hastings recently said that Amazon's losing up to $1 billion a year from the streaming video. And so that's basically them trying to go after Netflix and in the same way that Mike was saying, try to run them out of business by being cheaper than them and offering the same service. But ultimately, they're losing a lot of money on that, too, I think.
So I misstated the loss. Amazon reported $636 million in shipping losses in the quarter ending September 30th. $2.8 billion in shipping losses in the past year. $2.8 billion in shipping losses. That's 4.6% of its sales. They reported a net loss in that quarter of $274 million. Had they not had the shipping costs, they would have had a profit of $500 million.
On shipping.
Their total appears to be to take all the money they make from selling all this stuff and books and everything, and to take that money and squeeze the hell out of all their competitors by having impossibly low prices on everything and free shipping. That seems to be their whole business model.
Okay, here we are.
What is their business model?
Okay, revenue, $57 billion. Gross profit, $10 billion. So how are they losing money? I'm looking at the income statement here.
Oh. They're not losing money.
I thought they were.
They're losing money on shipping.
That quarter. That was the September 30th quarter. So maybe they made money another time.
They make the profit that they make, and then they use that cash instead of doing what Apple does, which has, $150 billion in cash by now. Instead of
not quite, but almost, I think.
Cash and being massively profitable like Apple, they take that money and they have free shipping and take a bath on shipping. They subsidize their tablets, which they're losing money on. They subsidize books, which they're losing money on. They subsidize all these other things that they lose money on because nobody else can compete with that.
But this only turns for them if they put everybody out of business.
It's turning now. It's fine. They're making $10 billion in profit. Gross profit, $10 billion. What's the problem?
But if you're a catalog.
That's in a quarter.
If you're a competitive catalog, it's a problem. And if you're a book publisher, it's a problem. And, you know, it's a problem for their competitors. I mean, like you said, Jeff Bezos is a genius. This is a brilliant idea.
So we're going to loan him the $3 billion? We're going to give him the $3 billion bond? We're going to loan him the money?
Yeah.
All right, good.
Jeff, the check's in the mail. So, good article.
Stock is $252 a share. Good luck shorting that.
Yeah, what's the price to earnings on that?
$138.
The highest? I think that may be the highest.
The trailing is $3,000.
I think that may be the highest in the market.
$3,000.
Go ahead and find somebody better than that. That's pretty good.
Yeah,
$138.
$138 price earnings.
I mean, times.
Times, yeah. It's a little high.
It's a little?
Yeah, well.
What's Facebook?
That's telling everybody that there's going to be growing and growing. I don't personally see it, but okay. The stock may be overpriced.
So a while ago, a hack, we talked about it, was revealed of, you know, the card keys in the hotels.
Yeah.
Cody Brocious, who's a software developer at Mozilla, demonstrated this at Black Hat. He reverse engineered, there's a company called Onity that makes most of these. He reverse engineers these card key locks that hotels use. He brings along a little device. They could be as small as a pen or actually a dry erase marker that you plug into the programmer port of these. They all have a port in the bottom, and you can unlock
it. I didn't know that.
Yeah, you can unlock
the
door.
There's a port in the bottom of those stupid handled things? Really?
Yes. Huh. And apparently, less than $50 in parts. He showed how to do it. It reads the digital key that provides access to the lock and opens it instantaneously. And apparently, according to Forbes, there have been a number of hotel break-ins lately. There it is. There's the dry erase marker. You stick that in the bottom, and boom, the door is open. There, but apparently,
well, that's what I call a serious bug.
Yes. So what's the fix? Well, Onity says, we're not going to ship a fix, but we are going to give you some putty you could stick in the epoxy putty.
Putty.
I kid you not that you could stick in the bottom of these locks that at least keep people from sticking anything in the bottom.
Huh.
Look at that. There it is. There's the hole. We're showing video. This is from Forbes.
Excuse duct tape.
Duct tape. That's just tape it up. Some people are kind of mad at Brocious, actually, because he did not contact Onity before he revealed this.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. You know.
Huh.
And, of course, there's many, many, many millions of these locks or hundreds of thousands of these locks in use. Seems unlikely that Onity is going to replace them all.
I wouldn't think.
Yeah. Putty. So, basically, you should probably put your laptop in the safe. That couldn't be hacked yet.
The other lesson for the hotel industry is if there's a Black Hat conference in town, don't.
You know, Brocious not only didn't alert Onity to its security flaw before his presentation, he licensed the technique for $20,000 to the Locksmith Training Institute.
Oh, that's actually a pretty good idea.
Wow, very smart.
More than a year before he made it public. They train law enforcement. So, I mean, that's, you know, it's not giving it to the hackers. It's giving it to the good guys. Brocious.
Yeah, because we all know that police have never gone in and planted evidence.
NoAgendaShow.com, ladies and gentlemen.
NoAgendaShow.com.
Twice weekly.
It's there.
Anyway, I guess a word of warning. Apparently, it's fairly easy. You can hide it, as you saw in that video. You can hide it in a dry erase marker, $50 worth of parts. His brochure said, hey, we don't know how long hackers, the bad guys have known about this probably for a long time. I just found it. Doesn't mean they haven't known about it
already. What's the point of the dry erase marker?
Just somewhere to, well, because you can carry that around.
You can carry it around anyway. When's the last time you were frisked? Give me a break.
You get caught. The hotel detective said, what is this dry erase marker for?
Yeah, really.
Well, I'm a whiteboard artist. I carry it around all the time. Enthusiast.
Enthusiast. I always like to mark things. Now, then they arrest you for being a tagger.
Yeah, right. Do I smell dry erase? All right, we're going to take a break. Come back with more. John C. Dvorak is here from the No Agenda Show and dvorak.com/blog.org/blog.
Right.
And do you know, you don't do
Market Watch, PC Magazine.
Market Watch. Yeah, you do a lot of writing, but you don't do like any more like that guy with a beard or anything like that anymore. Do you do that?
What, the tech hippie?
The tech hippie.
Or the tech grouch. The tech grouch.
You don't do that. You don't even know the name of the character.
There's two characters.
There's two?
Yeah, the tech hippie and the tech grouch.
You don't do that anymore, do you?
I wish I did. It was nobody watched it.
Was that nobody watched it?
Nobody cared.
See, that's the problem with podcasting. Nobody watches it.
Well, it wasn't very well marketed.
I don't think it's marketing.
Everything's marketing.
I don't know. You see this nice earring? I mean, what is that called?
A pinky ring.
Pinky ring.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's marketing.
I think.
If I come into a room.
I think you should go to the track.
The 7-carat amethyst.
With that baby on there.
Yeah, baby. You ever any gadgets you want to get rid of? Tim Stevens needs to know about this. He probably has. I'm betting you have a drawer right in that room right there, a drawer full of old phones and iPods and all sorts of stuff. Like that.
I might.
Yeah.
I might have multiple drawers.
I bet you do. John, I don't know if he still has this, but for years rented a room above a gas station.
You always like to bring that up.
I love that.
Yeah.
I'll never forget that.
That's where we're operating a company called Worldware 3.
You still have the room?
No, I got rid of it years ago, like decades ago.
It wasn't decades, but it was in 1992 that you took me up there because I said, John, I need a modem. And you said, come on up.
Come on up, we got modems. You want modems? We got modems.
You had shelves of modems. Yeah. Anyway, this is not a sensible plan. Because got to tell you, I bet you if you still had those gadgets, there'd be who needs a modem now?
Somebody.
You got to strike while the iron's hot and sell those gadgets now so you can buy new gadgets. And that's where Gazelle.com is so great. I love Gazelle.com. Visit Gazelle.com. They've simplified the interface. It's very straightforward. You got an iPhone, a cell phone, an iPad, an iPod, a MacBook, or a Mac that let's say, okay, you got in your drawer, you got a BlackBerry RIM. Maybe it's time to get rid of that. I actually have a torch in my drawer. It's in flawless condition. I never use the damn thing. Free of water damage? Yes. Let's see what Gazelle will give me. I bet you have $80. $85.
You've done this before.
No, I just guessed.
Well, then dump that thing.
$80 just sitting there. I didn't think it was worth anything. And now, if you've got an old iPhone, let's say you have a few Nokia phones, don't you, lying around, John?
Yeah.
Yeah, I bet you have, like, because you were really into that E71, right? How about a Lumi? Oh, I know. Let's say I did this. I bought an N9 because I want the Lumia because it's much nicer. Let's see if I could sell that N9 for anything. No, free of water damage, yeah. Look at that. I wonder if that's worth more or less than BlackBerry. $124.
I think that's a collector's item. You might want to hang on to the N9.
You think?
I think so, because that, in the long run, is going to be kind of known as an oddity. So I think you might want to hang on to that.
And this is why Tim has a drawer full of crap.
Yeah, he's got this attitude. I used to have this attitude.
That's going to be a collector's
really
item.
Really a bad idea.
Yes.
Hey, like Mimi comes really, really up. Oh, I see you've got another collector's item you're keeping.
I do save.
Throw this crap out.
I do save seminal phones, like the first iPod, the first iPhone. I do save those in our collection. We have a little museum here. But that's me and that's Tim because a normal person, you got an iPhone 4S and you're ready to get an iPhone 5. Let's go see what that AT&T iPhone 4S is worth. $215. That's going to get you the iPhone 5 right there. Boom. Bada bing, bada boom. Now, here's the beauty part. You throw all this stuff in a box. They send you the box. They send you the shipping label. These quotes are good for 30 days. So if you wanted to buy the new iPad, But you don't want to get, you don't want to send your old iPad until the new one comes. Keep it. You got 30 days to get the data off of it, to, you know, get the new iPad, and then you send it to Gazelle, and that offer is guaranteed for 30 days. By the way, they do wipe the data for you. They check it. They take care of all of that stuff, so you don't have to worry about it. GAZELLE.com. They pay shipping on anything worth more than a buck, and they'll pay you top dollar. They're really a good company. They have paid almost $50 million now to over 400,000 customers. I know. Jeez. That's pretty good, huh?
It's the business we should be
they
in.
They have a better model than Amazon, I got to tell you, for over 400,000 customers. Gazelle, GAZELLE.com. Do it today because I don't care what Tim says. That N9 is not getting more valuable.
I disagree.
You think it's
long tail, real long time down the road. Like post-apocalypse, you know, people are going to really be needing
this. Yeah, after the zombie apocalypse, people are going to say, anybody got an N9?
Kill.
N9.
Kill all
what
humans.
What do you think? Do you like the DNA? Should I be looking at that, Tim? Is that a hot? That's the new HTC phone. It'll be Verizon only.
Yeah. The DNA is a fantastic phone. I mean, it's really well made. The screen is amazing on it. I just bought myself a new Verizon phone, and I went with the Note 2, though, because of the battery life. The Droid DNA, unfortunately, the battery life is not exemplary on that, and it's not a replaceable battery, so once it dies, you know.
Why did they do that?
The Note 2 is much better battery life. It's not as nice looking. It doesn't feel as nice in the hand. The display isn't as nice. But for me, that was the one that I went with because I was looking for, you know, a big phone with a stylus.
Jason's
phone.
Got but one.
The DNA is great.
I bought the Note 2.
No, Jason has
the DNA.
DNA, I think, to review.
I want to. Oh, good. We'll review it on Before You Buy.
I think so.
And all about Android.
Yeah. So you can go over to Jason.
Oh, bring it over here.
It's a Verizon phone, though.
Well, it's a great phone.
I don't mind Verizon because LTE is so fast at Verizon, but it's not good for travel. Oh, I didn't even know we had one. This is the Droid DNA.
You guys don't even know what you have in this place.
It's called Gazelle.
Is it in that box?
You can't even open it.
Everybody's doing this. Apple influenced the whole industry. They all do these airtight boxes now.
Yeah.
It's like perfect. I bet you Apple invented the machines and now licenses it. You can't get this thing open because it's airtight.
What's the point?
Wow. To increase your expectations so that moment of unveiling is
exactly. And everybody's doing the same thing. Motorola's doing this. Where the first thing you see and Apple invented this. First thing you see is the device sitting there beautifully. Steve Jobs even talked about this in the Isaacson biography. And then they got the little tab and you pull it out and they hide all the, you know, wires and stuff underneath. This is Apple packaging. They ought to sue them.
I don't think you can sue on packaging.
Really?
Oh, you could sue on anything. Packaging companies, you know, they just
Anyway, yeah, so I was
heavy enough. This is heavy enough, seriously, as a package.
There could be a phone in it.
That you could sell it to somebody with no phone in it, which happens all the time, by the way.
eBay.
And then they get
the thing.
And
it takes them so long to open it, you're long gone. Just make sure you got a bicycle nearby.
There you go.
Wow.
It definitely could be used as a scam.
Okay, just a little tip from John C. Dvorak. Did you get Verizon, Tim? You did?
Yes, I did. I'm on Verizon. I'm actually grandfathered into their old unlimited data plan, so I'm pretty well stuck on Verizon at this point. But up here in Albany, we have really great LTE speeds, so I'm quite happy with Verizon. And I'm pretty happy with the Note 2 so far. I used it all day yesterday.
Love it.
Started at 6 a.m. and finally plugged in the charger at like 11 p.m., and it still had 20% charge left.
Can you do tethering?
Yes, you can.
You can do tethering. You have to pay extra for it, though. But
you have to pay extra. You don't have to do that with T-Mobile.
Of course. Well,
but then you have to use T-Mobile. If you could use T-Mobile with Verizon's network, now that'd be a deal.
That would be a deal.
Is LTE good up in Upper New York State too?
It's fantastic. Yeah, there's very good coverage, and not that many people with LTE devices yet. So I typically see 15 to 20 megabits. Now, actually, I'm over LTE right now. I use LTE as my home internet access because I am indeed way out in the boonies, and so we use LTE to the home here too.
There now here's the catch. If you get a subsidized Note 2 from Verizon or any new phone from Verizon, they will turn off your unlimited plan, won't they?
Yep. That's why I had to pay full retail price, which was a little bit painful to do. But at least I did get, you know, if I'm looking at cubic inches, I got a large phone for my money. So I guess I can look at it that way.
Well, and they charge $300 for it anyway. So you're only paying what? What'd you pay for?
$600?
$699.
Yeah.
That is weird. So they even admit this, that we will turn off your unlimited plan unless you buy it unsubsidized.
Yeah, you're forced to go into one of their new plans, which are all tiered. They also have their family sharing plans, which are
You know, they, for some people, that can work out pretty well. But ultimately, you know, all the offerings are tiered at this point, right. Which to me doesn't work because I do a lot of streaming through Spotify or Netflix on the road. So I definitely am one of the few who actually would go over their data caps and would be paying quite a bit more. So for me, it makes sense to pay full retail price for the phone and then keep my own data plan, which is, you know, just the way it's going to be, at least until they finally come up with some way, I'm sure, to force all of us who are grandfathered in to get off that.
Oh, they'll get you eventually.
Of course. Yeah.
You said something interesting. Are you on LTE right now? You use
right
this is
now.
This is your home internet.
Yes, yeah. Verizon launched, very quietly launched LTE to the home, actually. It's available nationwide, but they're not really making a big deal out of it simply because, you know, it's more expensive than your average cable or Fios connection, if indeed you can get Fios. I am in a place where I can't get cable or Fios. So it was either that or get like a T3 run to my house. And this is quite a bit cheaper than that, and the speeds are quite good.
It's really good. Look at that.
Yeah.
You're getting a great picture.
And we got another guy in Africa.
Thank you. Yeah, it's pretty amazing.
We get better connections to people in Africa or on LTE than somebody using Comcast down the street. I don't understand.
It's true.
Tim Stevens, we're going to let you go to dinner. Thank you so much. I appreciate you sticking around so late.
Hey, thank you. I'm happy to be here.
It's so nice to have you. Tim Stevens, editor-in-chief of Engadget at Engadget.com. I don't need to say much more than that. That's one of the most prestigious jobs in tech journalism.
Thank you. Can I say a quick congratulations before I go?
Yes.
Our founder, Peter Rojas, and his wife, Jewel, had a baby boy Friday evening, and I wanted to say congratulations to those two.
I didn't know that. That's great.
Yep. So congratulations.
I didn't even know Peter was married. So he's a sly cove.
Mm-hmm. They got to send him a gift now.
That is really great. But Peter's a regular on the show. I think he's one of the smartest guys out there. Founded both Gizmodo and Engadget, and now he's at GDGTGadget.com. Wow, that's great. Congratulations, Peter. And what's his wife's name?
Jill Fehrenbacher. She runs Inhabitat, actually.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm glad you mentioned that, Tim, and congratulations, Peter and Jill. That's fantastic. From Nairobi, Kenya, Mr. Mike Elgan. You can find him on Google+. That's where he lives, google.me/+MikeElgan.
Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, amazing. Again, you said that the bandwidth was good, but occasionally it goes out for 2 hours.
Yeah, occasionally there's a power failure, often associated with weather. Right now it's pouring rain, so we've been pretty lucky. But yeah, it's a great connection for the most part.
That's great.
Now, if you go to a coffee shop, there are no good connections in public coffee shops and stuff like that. The house I'm in here happens to have a really great connection. So it can be spotty, but for the most part, it's amazing.
What's your host paying a month for this connection?
I don't know. Mm. Probably a lot.
Yeah. No, you don't know that it's a lot. It could be low.
We don't know. And what time is it in Nairobi?
It is now 4:10 a.m.
All right.
Wow. Oh, I am so sorry.
Good morning.
No.
Mike, you stayed up all night.
You just got up early.
One or the other or both. I'm not sure.
But he's going back to bed as we speak.
That's I'm actually falling asleep right now.
Mike, I'm so grateful. I had no idea it was that late in Nairobi. Thank you so much for being here, and a belated happy birthday to you.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Yeah. I know that because I follow you on Google+, and every time I go to google.com, it keeps saying, Mike Elgin's birthday.
Yeah, you want to send him a card.
Mike Elgin's birthday.
Great. Send me some bacon vodka.
Thanks for staying up. By the way, don't go to google.me by itself. Because you'll get some, what language is that? It's Russian, I think. Google.me. It's not Russian. It's kind of Cyrillic. I don't know what the hell that is.
Macedonia, maybe?
Macedonia. It's Macedonian.
Yeah.
That's what it is. Wow. Look at that.
Either that or Maine.
Either Maine or Macedonia. Google me. Senuri de Jezuku.
Somebody says Montenegro.
Montenegro. I'm going to Montenegro.
You are when?
This fall.
All right.
It's on the way to the Bosphorus.
Ah, you're going to the Bosphorus, yes. I understand.
John C. Dvorak. Dvorak.org/blog.
ChannelDvorak.com.
ChannelDvorak.com. The real Dvorak on Twitter.
The real Dvorak on Twitter.
Was there a fake Dvorak?
Yeah, there's a bunch of them.
You're kidding.
No, I just said, screw it. I just used the real Dvorak.
I think that's an honor.
Yeah, maybe.
Everyone should have that honor. Thank you all for joining us. We do TWiT Sunday afternoons, 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern Time, 4 a.m. Nairobi time. Actually, it's 2400 UTC, so it's midnight UTC. That's why it's so late, and you're 2 hours after UTC.
Blame the Brits.
Wow. Blame the Brits. It's all their fault. You can watch it live, and we love it if you do. Join us in the chat room and all sorts of stuff. But if you can't, we got on-demand audio and video available, as we do of all of our shows after the fact, at twit.tv. Thanks for being here. We'll see you next time. Another TWiT is in the can.